moves, close calls.
We got it. Let's go.
And three victors already.
With my fingertips, I'll stand my ground tonight.
We're going to light them up, aren't we? He literally burned them down.
Time to bring the fire.
Today, the trucks return to Texas to take on the great American Speedway.
Sunshine and blue skies, the perfect combination to go racing at Texas.
Time to bring the fire.
The track may be wide. The racing here leaves no room for mistakes.
They were wrecking all the way down that straightaway.
Damn it. Damn it.
Bringing home jars of fame.
They say everything's bigger in Texas.
Ready.
Time to save the day.
Green flag is in the air.
Welcome back to the Lone Star State. This is race day from Texas.
Time to save the day.
Everything is bigger in Texas, and we expect nothing less when it comes to today's Craftsman Truck Series race in the Lone Star State. It's a mile and a half track, but it's unique in its own right, with plenty of challenges laying ahead for our series regulars. There's only two past winners in the field today, so could we see a new face get to victory lane? We're going to find out as the trucks, they take on Texas. Welcome in to race day on FS1. I'm Caitlin Vincey alongside two Texas past winners, I might add, and that would be Todd Bodine and Trevor Bain. Great to see the two of you. As always, we're in the Texas spirit today. We may have some headgear later that helps us with this.
I know all the tassels.
You're fringed out.
Are you excited about this race? What are you looking forward to?
Oh, man, I'm always excited about Texas. You crazy? Everything's bigger in Texas, including the truck series. This is the perfect racetrack. You run wide open in 3 and 4. You got a handle in 1 and 2. These guys know nothing but hammer down.
There you go.
How about
Todd's
it?
Excited today.
He's coming out of the gate.
He's
Texas.
Ready.
What do you got for that, Trevor?
I don't know if I got anything for Todd, but I'm excited to watch these truck drivers take on Texas. You know, this track takes a lot of discipline, Todd, to be able to get to the bottom, do all the things you got to do. Mile and a half racing. We saw some mile and a half racing already this season, but this is going to be a good one tonight.
Yes, it is. It's the second week in a row we've been in Texas. Last time out, we were in Austin, Texas, Circuit of the Americas. Zane Smith got it done, burned the truck down in the process. Here's how it all went down.
Oh, my soul to the sweet melody. Now I'm gone, now I'm gone, now I'm gone.
Okay, wow. So this is very unique. This gives a whole new meaning to a burnout, right, Trevor?
Burning it down. Did you ever try that technique? Did you ever try to just light it on fire when you were
No, but they said burn rubber, and he took it literally.
He really did.
Yeah.
Zane Smith on fire in more ways than one right now in the truck series. Okay, so the race today, qualifying happened earlier today out at the racetrack. We have some notable names we want to take a look at when it comes to the starting grid. The rookie, Nick Sanchez, he got the pole position. Good for him. You see some other newer faces, Corey Heim up there, along with some of the veterans a little further back with Stuart Friesen, Ben Rhodes. Zane Smith, the guy we were just talking about, has a little bit of work to do because he's starting deeper in the field. But what do you think about Nick Sanchez taking the pole?
I've been impressed with him all year so far. I mean, you look at Atlanta, his first time at that racetrack, goes out, finishes second, was sideways off of turn 4 battling for that win. And then he comes to a place like Texas where you don't have a lot of laps as a young driver at mile and a half races like this. I don't even know that he's ever seen Texas before this weekend. And so he comes in, qualifies on the pole. That makes a big statement. I know KBM has great trucks and Rev Racing is a partner of theirs with an alliance, but still super impressive for this young driver to be on the pole.
Well, everybody I've talked to about Nick Sanchez has all the same reaction. This kid studies and is prepared when he goes to the racetrack. He does his homework. He watches the videos. He studies the past races. He goes to the simulator. This young man wants it bad, and he's doing everything in his power, all the tools that are given to him to be better when he gets to the track, and it shows up every week. He is prepared.
So he did well at Atlanta, Trevor, another mile and a half racetrack, but this isn't Atlanta. This is a whole different, unique thing when it comes to Texas, right?
Oh, totally different. Yeah, Atlanta's a plate race now, pretty much. You know, you're wide open. Texas, for the first few laps is about wide open, but as the tires wear, that discipline comes in that I mentioned already in the show, making sure you can get to the bottom in turn 1 and 2 because the banking's gone now. When they repaved, reconfigured this track, they took all that away, and you got to make sure you hit your marks every time.
1 and 2 is tough at Texas now. You don't run wide open anymore.
Yeah, so if Nick Sanchez wants to win, he should take advice from the two of you because I, as I mentioned, I'm here with two guys who've been able to win in Texas. Take a look at the past success. First up for Mr. Todd Bodine, 6 wins. We're going to show pictures from
four, five.
Six of them, yes. Look at you. This was your playground.
Yeah, but I goofed up right here. We missed 08 and went right to 09.
09, then you went to 2010.
I think that let in slot, Todd.
Okay. And then what happened in 2011?
Yeah, you shut it down in 2010, so I had to pick up the flag.
Somebody had to do it.
That's right. We keep it going.
Look at this. Yeah, Trevor Bayne, of course, won 2011. So what are the keys to getting it done? What's the advice you would give to these young drivers to win it?
Well, Trevor already touched on a little bit. Turn one and two is really difficult. Three and four, forget about it. It's wide open. You run through there. It's like running down the highway. One and two is difficult. With the reconfiguration, it's really tough to get down in the corner because the track is flat as you enter. So you can really change your line as the run goes to the tires. I mean, to me, that's key, is figuring out, these young guys figuring out how to make your truck better through one and two as the run goes along, because it changes every lap.
Well, and you hear a ton of throttle time here in qualifying earlier today that we're watching now. And one and two, you know, you heard him breathe it maybe a little bit, but three and four now is the most banked corner of both ends of the racetrack. So you're right, it's wide open, but it's edgy. Even though you're wide open, the truck moves around a lot and the car does. But to me, when I won my Xfinity race, we were running the very top of this racetrack. We weren't running the bottom. It was the old style. But with both configurations, the restarts are very important. I won my race on a restart from fourth. Now we'll probably see that today with track position being huge in the truck series.
That's why I love the trucks at Texas. Man, the restarts are crazy. They're all over the place.
Absolutely. These drivers are going to have their hands full in more ways than one when it comes to this mile and a half track out there today in Dallas. Okay, we're just getting started, of course, here on race day. More to come, including talking about Stuart Friesen. He is the defending race winner out at Texas, hoping to get his season turned around a bit. But we also will deliver our race picks, who we believe could be victorious out there in the Lone Star State. Stay with us on FS1. Which is where we're racing today. There's Tyler Ankrum, one of the guys who's hopeful to get a win, has yet to go to victory lane this season, but maybe today could be his today. What about Ty Majeski? He was so strong last season, also has yet to win this year, but perhaps it could be today in Texas. He is starting third. So as we've talked about, we are in the Lone Star State, so we had to, there you go, partners.
Gotta put them on.
The hats. We love this. You've got a bunch of these hats.
Well, I had to borrow this hat. You said bring a hat from, I had to borrow this from wardrobe, because this is the hat that I brought.
No. Oh,
you didn't say
gosh.
Cowboy hat.
The other Texas hat back.
Come on.
It totally ruined it. All right. So we also have
Uncle Todd. He comes to birthday parties too.
Something.
He performs.
All right. We have an iconic Texas photo that I know our staff put together that apparently features all of us. I want to take a look at this, and you can explain. I do know what this is.
Now you guys, you know who is this, Caitlin. Come on.
That's the Dallas cast.
There you go.
Guess,
it's the Ewings from Dallas. Yeah.
I'm going with the hairstyle from now on.
I'm JR. Trevor's Bobby, and you're Sue Ellen.
Oh,
yeah,
Sue Ellen.
This is Texas.
You knew.
Didn't know.
Yeah, you gotta know Texas.
Okay, so before the break, we talked a little bit about Stuart Friesen. Last year, the Texas race was in late May, and it was Stuart Friesen who went to victory lane.
Yeah, this performance to me kind of caught us off guard last year. Qualified on the pole, won the race. Your buddy Stuart Friesen, Todd. Let him have it in Texas.
He let him have it. Well, I was trolling around in the back here, but Stewie was on it. They had great pit strategy, a fast truck, and Stuart loves this racetrack, and he flat got it done.
You know, sometimes everything just comes together. You like the body that's on that truck. You know, it handles great, and everything goes your way, and that's the night that they had. I'm sure he likes coming back here this year thinking it might be the same.
Yeah. Well, that was the plan.
That is the plan. That was a year ago. This season, all new year. So
thanks,
let's take a look at his numbers so far for Stuart Friesen. A bit surprising. Best of 14th twice at Las Vegas and Atlanta. So that is where he's at this point in the year. But, you know, very dominant performance from him. Second in both stages, led 60 laps. What are you expecting to see out of him today? Does this turn his season around?
Yeah, that performance last year kind of felt like an anomaly. It wasn't like a buildup to it, or that we saw that every week after. It just, everything went right on that day for Stuart Friesen. But you have that from time to time. You know, they've got great trucks. They've got great people. Blake Bainbridge there now as a crew chief. You mentioned a couple weeks ago. coming over. So, I mean, if all the stars align, it can happen again.
Sure
but
can,
it's just,
yeah.
you know, seemed like it was out of place last year.
A little bit, because they did struggle again in the beginning of last year. But, you know, bringing Blake in there, it was something that they needed to do. They just needed to make a change, right? But they have all the notes from last year. So I'm sure this truck is set up just like it was last year. He qualified well. Stewart loves the track. There's no reason they can't do it again.
Yep.
You two are friends. Did he call you up, get some tips?
No, he doesn't ever call me.
He doesn't need you anymore?
No, he
maybe
call
he should.
Me.
You got six wins
That's
there.
Right.
Okay. Stewart Friesen starting seventh for today. Let's talk about some other numbers to know heading into the race in Texas. So here you go. 42 Texas starts by Matt Crafton, which is most by 11. That's pretty significant. We've had 8 different winners in the last 8 on the mile and a half tracks, with 3 last lap passes in the last 5 on the mile and a half tracks, and 1 win by active drivers in the last 13 Texas races. That's a lot of numbers to remember, guys.
That is a lot of numbers. That last stat catches me off guard, because
sure
we have
does.
So much experience and so much talent. You know, Zane Smith, Ben Rhodes, Grant Enfiger, but only one of these drivers has won at Texas. That's crazy to me.
All right, let's take a look at the SpeedyCash.com 250 Victory Lane picks, who we think could get it done. I picked correctly last time, so I'm going to go first this time. Ty Majeski, we saw him briefly.
Yeah, okay.
I think Ty gets his first win of the year, and he does it today
He's happy
in Texas.
To see you pick him. He's
yeah,
like,
there you go. I'm good at picking
I'm
going
to go Corey Heim. I think it's time for Tricon to Garage to get a little momentum on their side. Corey's been leading the way for them, and it's time to win.
The last time I picked Christian Eckes, he won, so I know he's glad that I'm picking him again. I think they're on a roll. They got a good truck.
Those are some solid picks. You guys going to wear these hats the rest of the day? What do you say?
Let's go for it.
Maybe
I mean, we're not in Texas.
Let's go to the Cowboy Bar.
Let's do it, guys. Let's go to the Cowboy Bar. Yeah, for Todd, Trevor, myself, that does it for us on race day. Race coverage with Jamie Little and the guys is coming up after the break.
Deep in the heart of Texas, it's time to go racing. Welcome to Dallas, Texas on a beautiful day. All the truckers on pit road ready to go. We welcome you to the SpeedyCash.com 250.
Howdy, y'all. Welcome back for a little Texas two-step. The Truck Series battles in the Lone Star State for the second week in a row. Zane Smith set the road ablaze last time out in Austin.
Zane Smith burns it down.
So who's ready to cowboy up today? You don't mess with Texas.
There are no limits when it comes to the Fort Worth track.
It's bigger, badder, faster.
All over his tailgate. Hard in the outside wall.
Oh, no.
Saddle up. It's sure to be one wild ride.
Oh, man. We're going hard, guys.
It's race day in Texas. Craftsman Truck Series starts now on FS1.
Welcome to the Craftsman Truck Series live from Texas Motor Speedway. It is so good to have you joining us for race number 5 on the season. I'm Jamie Little, joined by Michael Waltrip and Phil Parsons. We're so glad you're back. And guys, we're back in Texas, but this week it's a little bit different. We're not turning left and right. It's a mile and a half track, Mikey.
And we're hammered down, Jamie. Let me take you down to turn 3. You're coming down the back straightaway. You see turn 3, nice banking, wide open through there. Come off turn 4, you got a lot of momentum. Get down to turn 1, things flatten out, and things can get in trouble. You can get in trouble down there in a hurry. We had it happen in practice when we're running basically alone. Caden Honeycutt into the outside wall, and then Tyler Hill off turn 2 gets loose. That's how flat this turn is. You can really lose your momentum. And by the way, you're approaching over 195 miles an hour getting into that corner. That makes it really intense. And when we put all these trucks out there together side by side with the air, Phil, we're in for a real thrill today.
Absolutely. You know, when we come to Texas, we always talk about those veterans rising to the top. I don't know. There's a couple of youngsters on the front row, and we only have 2 former winners in the field.
Yeah, but what about one of those former winners, Matt Crafton, one of the best we've ever had, a 3-time champion in the series. He's won here twice. Look, 42 starts at this racetrack alone. 30 of those resulted in top 10 finishes. But the thing I'm most impressed with, look at the very bottom. 11 drivers that are in this field weren't even born yet when he made his first start back in 2001. Plus, we have last year's winner, Stewart Friesen. Did such an amazing job. Led the most laps. This is the last lap. That's Christian Eckes on the outside. Stewart's going to get the best of him on the inside. They started this team about 3 years ago. They switched to Toyota, and this is the culmination. They got to victory lane here, and that propelled him into the playoffs last year. Stewart Friesen had a great year, and we've got a bunch of kids and a bunch of other veterans here that are going to give these guys their test.
That was a huge night for the 39-year-old from Canada. We'll see if Stuart Friesen can do it again. And, hey, this evening we've got two ladies covering all the action on pit road, Heather DeBow and Jamie Howe. And, Jamie, you're up first.
Well, a week ago on the Coda Road Course, strategy was everything. 14 of the top 16 teams all ran something different, and Zane Smith was able to use that strategy to get the win. That is not going to be the case here today. In fact, pit lane is only going to open for tire changes on three separate occasions. The first is going to come somewhere around lap 35 for a competition caution. The other two will be at the stage breaks. At that point, the field is going to be frozen. No advancements can be made, so any passing has to happen out on the racetrack, which is great news for the drivers who are already starting up front, like Jack Wood. He had his career best qualifying to earn his front row starting position. And while he has more seat time than Nick Sanchez alongside of him, he admits he does not have the experience being up front. So these first few laps are going to be full of lessons for him, Heather.
Absolutely, Jamie. And Nick Sanchez is starting on the front row for the second time this season, him capturing the pole here today. And when I talked to his crew chief, Danny Stockman, on how they got that job done, he said it all went into the preparation they did over the winter, their sim time, and studying the notes that they had from previous races. Now, he said Nick is like a sponge. He absorbs all the information and all the knowledge and applied it perfectly to lead the field to green here today. So we'll keep an eye on this rookie to see what he can do in the race here in Texas. But right now, let's send it to the pre-race stage for the command.
And now here to say the most famous words in motorsports, please welcome Community Choice Financial Operations team members, Larry Reisinger, Patricia Lopez, Jessica Lopez, Bill Chapman.
Drivers, start your engines!
Engines are fired. Everything in Texas is bigger, including tonight's race. 250 miles coming. Stuart Friesen won it last year. Zane Smith wants it. Can he get it done? A beautiful day in Austin, Texas. We are racing at Circuit of the Americas.
Zane Smith in the 38. Smoothest glass, running fast lap times.
This type of racing is like second nature for the 38.
That is a really fast 38 truck.
And here he comes, the last turn.
All right, check it back.
Zane Smith.
All right, baby.
He'll win it. We welcome you back to Texas Motor Speedway. Yes, Zane Smith doing very Zane Smith-like things. It's almost a carbon copy of what he did at this point last year.
Yeah, but look at the last 29 races, 7 wins. Next closest, Chandler Smith with 4.
What about that nearly 600 laps led? That's really impressive as well. That just tells you from the beginning of the race to the end how dominant the 38 has been.
But he's been consistent his entire career. 3 years in the Truck Series, a second, and first in points.
And he's got SpeedyCash.com on that number 38. Truck looks fast. He didn't qualify as well as I expected, guys, but I bet you he races his way to the front. What do you think, Bill?
I think he will, for sure.
Let's take a look at the Craftsman track description. This track is 1.5 miles in length, but I'm telling you, I alluded to it in the opening, that turns 1 and 2 with 4 degrees less banking. These trucks, they weigh over 3,000 pounds. They're going to go in there about 190 miles an hour. They need the banking.
It's plenty wide enough, isn't it?
Yeah, you got plenty of room to slide up and hit the wall, which is what I think we're going to see some of that tonight in turns 1 and 2.
Let's take a look at our race analysis. You see this race is 167 laps, 250 miles. Our stage one is 77 laps, and we will have a competition caution on or around lap 35. You see our second and third stages of 45 laps, and as Jamie Howe alluded to, you cannot improve your position on the pit stops after these stage breaks.
And the reason for that, Phil, all the pit crews are in Richmond.
They're all in Richmond. There's nobody left to pit the cars, trucks.
Let's take a look now at the SpeedyCash.com starting lineup. We had a little practice session earlier, and qualifying took place. Nick Sanchez on the pole for the second time this season.
Right beside him, Jack Wood. I like what I'm seeing out of Jack. I think he's going to have a great night tonight. Corey Heim looking to rebound. He's had a couple problems this year.
What a great start to the season for Christian Eckes in that 19 truck for Bill McAnally Higelman.
You talked about it earlier, Phil. Stuart Friesen with the win here last year. And I got to talk to Tyler Ankrum about his cows and his truck. He's really pumped up about Texas.
Another solid start to the season for back in row number 5, Ben Rhodes, a former champion.
Grant Enfinger, you know he's going to be a factor. Good speed from Chase Purdy again this week.
Raja Carruth trying to break out and have the run that we expect him to, and he's capable of.
All the way back on row 9.
He's going to put on a show for us. I'm excited to watch that 38.
Daniel Dye, he'll be carrying one of our onboards. He's back in row number 10.
There's the man you talked about. You said he was old, Phil. Is that basically what you said, Matt Kraft?
Well, I don't know if I said it in those many words.
Kobe Hired, always fun to watch. We'll see if he can battle his way through the field. Haley Deegan there.
See, Matt Bell's making one of, I think, 3 starts for Tyler Young this year.
Armani Williams in the 46 truck, starting on row 16 alongside Keith McGee, and there's Matt Benedetto. He's going to be fun to watch charge through the field as well.
He had a problem in practice. They had something go wrong with the suspension in the right front. Didn't get a chance to qualify, so that'll be fun to watch the 25 truck. Right, let's get a quick check on stories to watch for. Here's Heather.
And Jamie, you mentioned it, for the second week in a row, Matt DiBenedetto plagued by mechanical issues. At COTA, they had a broken shock mount. Today, the right front suspension had an issue. But I talked to him after practice, and he said, you know what, even though we had that issue, I have a really fast race truck today. I believe we have top 10 speed here, so he's confident that he can get himself up through the field. But you'll definitely want to keep an eye on the 25 here during the start of the race. He told me his plan is to go to the outside, make it 3, possibly 4 wide, to capture as much trucks here on the top of the start, because as we know, track position is vital here in Texas today. Jamie Howe?
I'm going to go back to our reigning champion, Zane Smith. We talked about it's been pretty close to rinse and repeat for him from last year to this year. Started off with wins at both Daytona and at COTA. He's been in the mix at all the others. And the expectation was to come here and qualify better than their 15th place starting position last year. But it came down to what they unloaded with, and they were set up for cooler conditions. So Zane lines up back on the 9th row. The task at hand, in his words, is treacherous. It's very hard to pass here. Cannot use the advantage of his pit crew, and he hasn't shown the speed that's needed yet. But what he does have is a good relationship with his crew chief, Chris Lawson, and they have the ability to work together, execute changes, and so getting up front early is going to be key, and then maintaining it is the focus going forward. Jamie?
Yeah, that's been a very impressive pairing there, that driver-crew chief relationship. Obviously, they're knocking him off. Big win last week. We've got a few onboards to watch for, gentlemen.
Yeah, as we've mentioned, Daniel Dye will be carrying one of our onboards. Daniel was second last year in Arca Menards points, and he's starting 20th in the SpeedyGash.com 250. And this is the shop, DanielDye.com. On
just ahead of him, Zane Smith. So Daniel can look up there and see Zane. He's in that 38 SpeedyCash.com truck, and he's carrying our SpeedyCash.com camera. That's a lot of speedy caches, and he's going to be speedy as he tries to cash in here tonight in Texas.
We're going to ride along with last year's winner, Stuart Friesen. Different look this week for Stuart Friesen. He has Ferris Mowers, a red truck. He's normally has a blue truck, and he starts from the 7th spot.
I'm a lawnmower race Stuart next week, Phil.
Are you going to get him?
I think I can take him.
All right.
We're both going to be mounted up on Ferris mowers, see what we can do.
This is in Bristol.
Yeah.
If you want to go, if you're in Bristol, come watch Michael Waltrip race.
Thursday night, is that correct?
Tractors.
Thursday night. I'm going to put my helmet back on, Jamie.
That truck looks great. I really like that new sponsor. Great for that team to have somebody so involved, so interested and invested in our sport. So we've talked about the pit road procedure a little bit different. Sometimes we refer to it as non-competitive stops. That's only because they can't lose or gain a position once that caution falls and they have to come down pit road, and this is how it'll look.
Yeah, I think this is a great move. As we talked about, all the pit crews are in Richmond for the Xfinity Cup doubleheader. There really aren't that many pit crewmen available, so NASCAR decided to do this. It's fair for everybody, and it's a real cost savings too. It would, even if you had to fly a pit crew out, if they were available, you're talking about $5,000-$7,000 per team. So I think it's a great idea.
And I love the difference between last week and this. I was talking to Chris Lawson down in the garage area, Zane Smith's crew chief, last week, and he's like, Mike, my computer's burning up. It's smoking. I've got so many different scenarios for strategy. And turned out strategy did help them win that race. Tonight,
did he turn it on? Did he turn his computer on?
I don't think he even brought it. Tonight, it's all about speed and making passes on the racetrack. It isn't anything to do with strategy, and NASCAR's done a nice job of helping these teams save some money and still having some great racing.
And something else, a lot of the spotters, they're back in Richmond. So there's not only different spotters on the box for these gentlemen and lady, but there's a lot of IndyCar spotters that have never worked with these drivers before because it's a doubleheader with IndyCar. So interesting.
Matt Crafton is the only driver in his field with his regular spot.
Different voices in their heads.
That sounds like me.
They make their way out of turn four here. Nick Sanchez, so quick earlier on today. Jack Wood to the outside. Green flag is in the air. We are racing at Texas. Great start by the two, and Nick Sanchez with a big push from the 98 right behind him, and they're three wide going out of turn two, guys.
What about Corey Heimfield? Got up on the outside of Jack Wood. He's going to make it work. It looks like, are they four wide?
We got a spin already. You talked about turn two and how treacherous that is.
Chad Chastain, the brother of Ross Chastain, in the wall hard coming out of turn two with a lot of damage.
Ah, that's a shame. That's the challenge of turn two, especially in turbulent air. The further back you go, the harder it is to hang on to your truck, and it got away from Chad. You don't know if there was some contact or what exactly might have happened back there, but it's just a really tough day's work to be back in the beehive where he was.
Tough break for one of the three Al Neese trucks. It's a home game for Al Neese from Texas.
Chad qualified in the 22nd position right alongside Matt Crafton, so I'm sure there was a lot of optimism. Is that Daniel Dye way up high,
looks
losing
like,
a
looks
little
like
bit
he,
of grip? And
there might have been some contact before, but when we first saw him, he was by himself.
Something to note here, you see that top groove is really dark. There is no traction compound. That's just left over from last year, so has an interesting look to it. Here's another look at what happened with Chad Chastain.
Yeah, you can see he just got loose and lost control. We saw just ahead of him, Daniel Dye had the same issue, was able to hang on to his truck. So the team will try to patch it up maybe, or they might just say it's too much damage. You know, Phil, at a mile and a half going 190 miles an hour, like I talked about, the aerodynamics are obviously very important, and this truck's a mess.
Yeah, without a doubt. We didn't, you know, only had about 10 minutes of practice because of the two incidents you mentioned. So these guys didn't have a whole bunch of time on this racetrack, Jamie Howe.
No, but IndyCar did have a substantial amount of track time as the morning and the afternoon went on today. And one of the sessions that they had just before the trucks got ready to come back out here was a session that they called their groove session, where they were only allowed to run the high side of the racetrack. The goal of that is to get some rubber down and to try and widen out the racetrack. The truck teams had not been out there and experienced that just yet. So these first couple of laps, we'll see how usable it is in the early stages, but they did something to try and help us out.
That's interesting. I'd like to hear from the drivers just what it feels like and how different it is from their session earlier. Caution is out for the first time today. Welcome back to Texas Motor Speedway, where we are under caution for the first time with an incident. Exiting turn two, Chad Chastain. Let's go back and take a look at that.
Yeah, we were on board with Daniel Dye on this restart, and this is what a wreck almost looked like. Listen. Just ahead of Chastain, that was Daniel Dye paddling it off turn two, and he hung onto his truck, but unfortunately behind him, Chastain wasn't able to.
Yeah, good heads up move by Daniel Dye to realize that he was in trouble up there. You saw all those trucks on the inside running wide open around the bottom of the racetrack.
I think this track will widen out. They'll be able to use more of it, but early in the going, it's always a little bit dicey when you're on new tires and bringing up the air pressure. And again, like I said, in all that traffic and turbulent air, just makes it difficult.
On board with Daniel Dye right there.
I ordered me some hair product at shop Daniel Dye.
He has great
Did
hair.
You? Yeah.
The choose has been done. Nick Sanchez leads them. We're back to green.
What a great initial start Sanchez got. And you know, Phil, the top four trucks on the bottom all chose the bottom. One through four took the bottom. That allowed Eckes in the 19 Napa truck to pull up, and he took advantage of it. Off turn two, he's going to grab second.
Three wide behind him.
Ty Majeski was in a hurry, but he was wiggling in that 98 truck, and he goes backwards, lost a handful of positions.
Carson Hocevar does a nice job in that blue truck, blue and yellow truck, to grab a few spots.
A lot of trucks swinging wide off turn four, but everybody so far headed in the right direction.
The choose was interesting. We had about five or six take the inside. Neck has said, excuse me, coming through. I'll take.
Whoa, look way up top.
Jack Wood way up there where Daniel Dye was early in the race.
Man, you start second. You want that track position. We talk about how important just passing trucks and being fast is tonight. No way to make up things with strategy. He just gave all that qualifying away. Looks like he's really loose right now, Phil.
It sure does. Got Dean Thompson, the five blue and black truck right behind him.
Raja Carruth right behind him.
Able to make a nice run on Brett Holmes there, but then slides up, and Thompson in that five is going to take advantage of it off turns two. And here comes Roger looking even lower. Oh, into the outside wall.
Is that the 0-2 of Chris Wright?
Chris Wright gets the wall a little bit there. He's able to keep it on the track.
I don't like this, Jamie. That'll blow out a right front tire.
Looks like that outside groove is really slippery from what I've seen so far.
I didn't see any tire smoke, though, but that was a lot of contact. Watch him slip and slide into the wall. Bam.
Just got up high and probably tried to carry too much throttle through there. This is Daniel Dye's onboard. You see him up ahead. Just got up in the with the old traction compound. Just not a lot of grip up there.
What about Danny Dye not ever coming off the gas? He saw him up there slipping and sliding. He just kept the hammer down.
Chris Wright was 21st at the time when he touched the wall.
Try to take a few laps to feel it out, make sure he doesn't smell any smoke. See Zane Smith now. Zane is already up to the 12th spot.
And Phil,
that was 18th place starting position.
This could totally be a situation where they have a little bit more downforce built into their truck so that they know when they're in the draft and in traffic, they're going to have a lot of speed, because that's a pretty big move for just a few laps.
And sometimes it's a trade-off. Sometimes these guys will trim these trucks out knowing they pretty much run wide open if you're right qualifying. Ooh! Contact between Matt DiBenedetto and Haley Deegan.
That was a close one. Heather, what's the 25 saying?
Well, on that first initial start, he said it's very icy anywhere but the bottom. So he said, you know, my plan's not really working out here. How he wanted to take the top, as I mentioned early on in the race, and pass as many trucks as possible. They just came over the radio and told him the 13 was the next one that he needed to pass, and we saw contact there. So really icy. They get a little bit loose as he tries to take the 13 here on the inside.
That's battle for the 20th spot right there as Matt DiBenedetto in the 25 drops to the bottom and gets around Haley Deegan.
Man, that was close.
I think he got there so quick. I'm not sure. When we talk about not having the usual spotters.
It's like Daniel Dye is a member of our broadcast team. Replays brought to you by Daniel Dye. Thank you very much.
I don't think Haley Deegan was aware that Matt DiBenedetto had driven up beside her.
There's a battle for the lead. Christian Eckes right on the tailgate of the two truck of Nick Sanchez, and you can see just behind them Ben Rhodes looking on. This hasn't been a great track for Ben Rhodes. Doesn't seem to get it done here as well as he had hoped to. Only two top fives and 12 starts, so needs to see if he can get one tonight, and I bet he does.
But a great start to the season, yeah, though, for Ben Rhodes. 11th is his worst finish this year.
I was just going to say, he's on a roll.
Yes.
And that momentum in sports is everything, and he and Zane Smith have that right now.
It's Colby Howard, that 9 truck. He's looking pretty strong early.
Battle for the 20th spot back there. Some decent trucks. A Taylor Gray, who jumped in the truck on his birthday last week at COTA. Now he'll be full-time in the Craftsman Truck Series. Just turned 18, so he can run all these tracks running here for the first time.
Yeah, this is the first time he's ever been on any mile and a half. So I'm sure his eyes are wide open here at Texas. He's got a good one to follow, too, that yellow number 88 of Matt Crafton.
Been a steady start for Matt, just probably shaking off some of the early laps diciness that this track has brought the drivers. Matt's a veteran, so he's going to be patient and take his time and fill out his truck.
You know, we were watching qualifying earlier today. Obviously, it was not on TV, and we were listening to Matt. And when they told him his lap time, he couldn't believe it was that slow. So it may be the same situation you were talking about, maybe with a little more downforce built in that truck, Michael, to perhaps to have this comfort in race trim.
See Tyler Ankrum there in the 13th spot right now. Michael, I know you hung out with him On race day, we showed a little feature about him. What'd you learn about the cows and the farm and all that?
He's just as all into it. He goes to the gym in the morning, heads over to the shop, and then heads to the farm and helps his family raise cattle. Have about 80 head, and he's just really thinks it's a good place for him to decompress and get away from the racing. And if you think about this kid, he showed up, he won the ARCA championship, he won a truck race right off, and then things haven't gone that great. So you do need to decompress, and you need to make sure you're still confident. And he loves this track, always runs well here, best finish of third. So a lot of confidence for Tyler Ankrum in that 16 truck.
22-year-old out of San Bernardino, California, lives in North Carolina now. But, you know, the big question, Michael, is did you clean up your shoe? I believe you had an accident.
We had a lot of fun, and my grandchildren gave me some nice new shoes, and I mistakenly wore them there.
Well, they ruined them.
They're a mess. They're a mess, Phil.
Heather.
And you mentioned, Michael, that he loves racing here in Texas. This is the first mile-and-a-half track that he ever raced on. Also, he said this track is very similar to Kentucky, where he got his first truck win that you spoke about. But he said today he felt really confident coming into this race. He said he felt better after qualifying because they struggled with speed here in the past. And also, compared to Vegas earlier this year, he said they showed up with more speed here today. Jamie Howe?
Go back to talking about Matt Crafton and how he was so surprised when they told him what his qualifying time was this morning. Then he thought that they were actually playing an April Fool's joke on it because the truck just felt so good. He didn't even believe it. He said, our truck is amazing. It's balanced. Apparently, it's just not that fast. What he was hoping for is the sun was going to stay out all day and it would get greasy, and that would require the driver to have to actually make some moves and do some passes. You see him going around the outside right now to try and make it happen, and that's kind of what has happened. The track is a lot slipperier than it was this morning, so Matt could move up potentially. Jamie?
Yeah, no April Fool's jokes here. That truck is loose. Yeah.
He had his hands full down there in 3 and 4.
He rallied in 1 and 2, though, and took the spot back away from Taylor Gray. Watch the 88 as he gets down into turn 3, side by side with Jack Wood, and his truck just got loose on the bottom. We're going to see that a lot tonight. He couldn't quite keep up with it.
Did a nice job holding on to that truck. Those trucks on the inside, when they have a truck on the outside, they lose so much of that downforce. Plus, he had Taylor Gray right up behind his tailgate.
Nick Sanchez. It's been all about the two truck. They've been so strong. Danny Stockman, they've got it going. Continues to lead here, 21 laps in here at Texas Motor Speedway. Stay with us.
Here is where it must be left on the track.
Blow those rear tires off us, bud.
And now is when the future is written in the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series.
Tomorrow, the NASCAR Cup Series is right here on FS1. Catch some heated short track action from Richmond, where each lap is its own test. The Toyota Owners 400 begins tomorrow at 3:30 Eastern, with pre-race coverage at 2 o'clock. That'll be fun. Always good to be in Richmond. I'll be there following this race. I'll fly up there and be on pit road. Should be a sunshiny, beautiful day.
Just like it is here in the heart of Texas. Check this out. This is what happened when we were going to break. Chastain goes around again in the outside wall, and that, Jamie, is going to end his evening.
Yes, it is. That brings out the caution for the second time, and he has taken that truck back to the garage.
Yeah, the aerodynamics of that truck were obviously compromised after that first incident, so it's not too surprising that he didn't have much to lean on there.
And these teams aren't allowed to pit until the competition caution that's coming up in about 10 laps, so we're going to choose here. We saw what happened last time, first four trucks to the bottom. This time, it's a different story. They learned, didn't they?
Well, Christian showed them that the outside would work, so Stuart Friesen jumped up on the outside with him.
So a mixed bag, pretty much. Nick Sanchez sticking with what he knows.
I like it.
And the 88, I believe, just came to pit road. Jamie.
Yes, when pit lane opened under this caution, we saw Matt Crafton being loose out there. They did make some adjustments. performance, but that was not the initial reason he came to pit lane. He was getting an error that the oil temperature was too high. They brought it in, checked it all out. Everything seemed fine, so now they think it's probably a gauge that's just misreading. He does not have the new digital dash in. He's back to the old school setup inside of the truck. But I think everything is fine, and they did tighten him up a little bit, too.
Thank you for the update there.
Yeah, they're not allowed to change tires during any other caution than the competition caution or the stage breaks, and they cannot put fuel in it until we get to that competition caution on lap 35. But obviously, Matt needed some adjustments.
And then also, Phil, these teams feel like they're going to take four tires each time they pit on the competition caution and the two stage breaks. That's straightforward what we're going to see here for strategy.
And they will have to take tires first before fuel. There's some different rules about it. You see it in the ARCA Menard series. Pace truck is off. Nick Sanchez, Christian Eckes, we're racing once again.
Keep your eye on that light blue truck on the inside. That's Carson Hocevar. And oh well, by the way, here comes Corey High. He didn't get the start he wanted, but Carson was really fast in the first few laps of this race, and we know he's a win just waiting to happen. But wow, that was a bad restart for him.
But a great restart for Corey Heim, as you mentioned, made it three wide, made it stick. Now he's on the inside of Ben Rhodes.
Side by side they go. Nick Sanchez, Christian Eckes, Ben Rhodes, and Corey Heim.
What about Christian Eckes? Got her wound up again this week.
Both of these drivers having great seasons. Christian Eckes, of course, with a big win a couple of weeks ago at Atlanta, celebrating with his brand new team for the year. A lot of confidence. I know last week was different. It's a road course. They didn't have the result that they wanted there, but this 19 team, I think we're going to be talking a lot about him this season.
Well, he's running second now, and he's had two runner-up finishes here at Texas, so he likes this racetrack. And he's strong early.
Remember, we showed Stuart Friesen passing Christian Eckes on the last lap last year to get the win.
What kind of transition, Phil, do you think this truck will go through as it cools off into the evening? Will we see the trucks come and go, or do you think it's pretty straightforward? Look at this mess.
Look at Matt Crafton all the way down to the bottom of the racetrack. I think we'll definitely see this racetrack change, and I would think as it cools off and we get a little bit more rubber down, I would think, if anything, it may go towards the tight side. So the crew chiefs are going to have to be on top of that and make adjustments for that.
Matt had that pit stop, and he's already back to where he was, 18th, so the adjustments must be paying off for him here.
And remember, no tires. He has the same tires he started the race on.
Wow, look at all that traffic. That'll make you nervous, won't it? Especially if you're a veteran like Crafton that's seen a whole lot of stuff go down, watching these trucks bounce and slide around.
And so many of these drivers that he's really never raced around much. He's trying to race right now with Raja Karuth. You know, Matt hasn't raced a whole lot. Raja had a handful of starts last year, but Matt hasn't spent a lot of time racing around Raja Karuth and a lot of the other guys.
How about Zane Smith up 12 spots after qualifying 18th? He's now found himself up there in the mix in sixth.
We had a feeling he might be towards the front, didn't we?
And he made most of that ground on the restarts. He got about five trucks on that last one, so he must be very confident with that 38 truck in heavy traffic, which kind of talks about what we said earlier. He might have a little bit more downforce than some of these others, and hopefully as this track changes, that grip will pay off for him. As you see Carson in that light blue truck making moves back toward the front. I like the speed of this 42 early.
They lost a lot of ground on that.
Sideways, a heck of a save for Tanner Gray.
Well, Tanner got into Carson Hocevar. Both of those guys almost lost it.
Look at
and
this
back in the 10th spot right there. Trucks all over the place. Carson Hocevar in 10th, and it looks like maybe the 16 of Tyler Ankrum's got a fender rub.
Yeah, Colby Howard, the 9 truck, got into Tyler Ankrum's left rear quarter, and that's what was rubbing right there.
And when that truck goes in the corner, the G-forces pushes it over to the right, and that's why you see that left rear fender rubbing. Wouldn't be surprised if that doesn't cause a flat
tire. Looks like
flat
a pretty significant rub, doesn't it, Mike?
Nothing on the straightaway. You load up the truck in the corner.
The body shifts to the right. Gets that left rear tire closer to the fender.
And I might back her down if I'm Tyler Ankrum. Not take a chance. We got a competition caution in just a couple laps.
I was just going to say, do you just take that chance knowing that competition caution's coming out here in about 2.5 laps?
Slow down if I was him.
Yeah, battle for the third spot.
Ty Majeski there in the 98, some really good, a great start, and then a great restart, got shuffled back just a little bit.
Good battle here with Corey Heim.
Got first four teammates now running third and fourth with Ben Rhodes and Ty Majeski. Both of those drivers off to terrific starts here in 2023.
What about this start?
Meanwhile,
it's a pretty darn good start here, too.
Over a second lead for Nick Sanchez over Christian Eckes. He learned a lot at Las Vegas. Remember how good he was there? Led about eight laps. Ran around Kyle Busch, who they have a technical alliance with KBM. Kyle gave him some great advice. Told him, take what the truck can get you. You know how good these trucks are. Don't push it too much. And I think he's going to apply that here today.
Yeah, I listened to him after qualifying earlier today, and he just was so confident because of his team. He kept emphasizing how much the team meant to the success he was having and the great crew behind him. Lap 36 on the board. We should see the yellow here before long. That's something that Tyler Ankrum is anxiously awaiting. That team can get that fender pulled away, and there's the caution.
There it is, third caution of the day. This one is the competition caution. This is that, well, I'm going to say gaggle of trucks back there around the 10th spot.
Going to be some contact right there.
That was close, Phil.
Yeah.
I talked about how flat that corner is. You're barely hanging on to the pickup truck anyway, and you can see Gray into Hosovar, and he did it. Both of them did a nice job hanging on. But unfortunately, lost a lot of ground. And then watch this mess.
Watch the 9 of Colby Howard go to the inside. Looked like Tyler Ankrum drove down there to block him, and Colby was already there. They made contact.
When I talk about speeds of 180, 90 miles an hour, things happen quickly. His spotter probably didn't get the message to him soon enough.
That's one team that's happy. This competition caution flag is out. Some pit stops when we come back. Welcome back to the SpeedyCash.com 250, and you see it there. All trucks have come to pit road, and remember, these are non-competitive stops, so they look and sound a little bit different, Heather.
Yes, they do, Jamie. And for the two, our leader, Nick Sanchez, he told them over the radio that he was only giving it 90% right there, just trying not to burn the tires up. He said he feels really good about that truck and likes the balance from lap one all the way to lap 35, so they're not going to make any adjustments here for the two. One thing they did say, though, is when he pulled into his box, they felt like he was a little bit too close to the wall, so good thing they have 3 minutes here to work that out. And then also we'll move a little further back in the field to the 11th position of the 16 of Tyler Ankrum. As we saw, he did have a fender rub there. They told him over the radio when that happened, just be smart and we're going to make it to the end of this stage. Luckily, they did. Also, Doug Randolph is reminding the crew guys what their role is. Like, Mike, you're going to be torquing the tires here. So it's kind of interesting to listen to them on that. But he did say that he's a little bit loose, so he'd like to tighten it up in the rear to help him late in the run. So they also made a track bar adjustment. Jamie Howe?
For Christian Eckes, he was running second when this competition caution came out. And you talk about those adjustments that the crew has to make to their new roles. Charles DeNike, the crew chief for Christian Eckes, actually went over the wall. He made some of the adjustments on the truck, and all of his guys really had to rally together to get out there, just like all of the teams up and down pit lane. And Christian was able to drive from sixth, where he started, all the way up to second. He said that was really one of his focuses when he started off this year. He used to save some for the end of the race, but he said that doesn't do me any good in getting points. And he didn't make the championship four last season because of the bonus points. So his strategy all season is to just go hard, get up there, and do the best that he can with the stages. Ben Rhodes in that number 99 machine, when I talked to him earlier on, he said that he wanted top 10s all year. We talked about how he had that 111th place finish at Daytona. We thought it was a shining season. He said, no, that's a black spot on my season. He wanted a top 10, and he started off with an 11th. So his new goal is to finish all of the laps for the season. It's been done once by his teammate Matt Crafton back in 2013, but that's his focus. The only way he can make all of the laps is to make these adjustments, continue to be happy with the truck. He feels like he's got something pretty solid underneath him to go back to green. Jamie,
can I tell Heather to tell Doug Randolph that I'm not in position to torque the tires? I can't get there.
If you have a hard card and you're on the roster, Michael, you can gladly go.
Maybe they recruited
over
me because they're non-competitive. I don't know, but I can't get there.
Oh, love Dallas, Texas. The horses, horsepower. Want more of it? Tonight, right here on FS1. It's a star-studded showdown as Jose Ramirez and the Guardians face off against Julio Rodriguez and the Mariners. MLB action from Seattle tonight, 9:30 Eastern on FS1. Baseball is back.
I like baseball.
And so is racing.
And we're going to choose, Jamie. Look at there. It's out of the first three to the outside.
It's really split now. Where before it was all inside bias, now it's really split.
I love the choose rule. It takes luck out of it. You know, you get where you get because you go where you want to go.
Heather.
Well, Jamie, we talk about mistakes on pit road that happen when we have live competitive pit stops, but we just had a mistake here for Tanner Gray. The team put on the right rear tire on the left side and the left rear tire on the right side. Luckily, they caught it and had to make that change really quick, but they only had about 2 seconds left to torque down those lugs.
Oh, wow.
I've had that happen before. You know, unfortunately, it is wicked.
It's a mess.
Yeah.
But I didn't really like calling them non-competitive pit stops because putting a tire on and doing everything, your job, that is competition.
I bet those boys look like they were in tip-top shape running over that wall fixing that mistake.
That might have been the fastest tire change of the whole year when they had to get those tires squared away.
We got a glimpse at Las Vegas what would happen when we had a bunch of pit crews late on an airplane. And remember, Kyle Busch came down pit road without his regular crew. Normally, they do anywhere from 13 to 15-second pit stops, and it was a 30-second pit stop. So that's how trained and how athletic those real pit crew members are.
That's how racing used to be, right? It was the mechanics working on the truck.
Exactly.
They go over the wall.
But I could change a lot faster than 30 seconds.
Oh, really? I want to hear more about that as we go back to racing with Nick Sanchez in control.
Man, that scares me when they kick up that dust. And make a mistake right there and tear the whole nose off your truck if you just get too low. And that just goes to show you, Phil, you really, when you're tucked in like that, you can't see what's ahead of you. You're just at the mercy of the guy you're following.
You're following the guy behind you. That's all you can see.
This is a great shot. Look at Zane Smith up in the mix. Started mid-pack. Now he's up there giving us a great view of what's happening up ahead.
Neckes is hanging right in there.
Yes, he is.
On the outside of Sanchez.
This is when the draft really plays a big part of it, pulling you up toward the truck in front of you.
What a strong move by Sanchez into the corner.
Oh, got one going high.
Ben Rhodes on the bottom in the 99, side by side with Eckes now, trying to take that second spot. 190 miles an hour, side by side.
And sideways for Ben Rhodes as well. But he stayed in it, now he's gonna pull back up beside Christian Eckes. Let's see who Zane goes with and try to give him a little bit of a push.
Oh, man, this is going to be difficult for that 99 truck of Rhodes hanging onto it. Real easy to get sideways down on the bottom.
Christian Eckes is keeping that left front corner right over next to that right rear quarter panel.
Look at Dean Thompson squeezing up in the sixth position. I've been looking for some good runs out of Dean, and he's putting one together here.
Dean Thompson
in that blue and black number 5.
Right in front of one of his teammates, Corey Heim, in the 11, the black and red truck.
Dean's going to look up top, as is Zane Smith. This is fun racing.
Nick Sanchez is enjoying it as well.
That looks so good in your rearview mirror. Wow. Carson Hocevar about wipes out he and Tyler Ankrum.
Great saves by both of them.
Tyler Ankrum, he's had his hands full today. Mentioned Dean Thompson in the 5 driving for Tricon Garage this year. He had a good run at Las Vegas the last time we ran on a true mile and a half racetrack, but no top fives yet this season. No top 15s, as a matter of fact.
Yeah, but he had a top 10 truck, as you're talking, in Vegas, and had some issues that took him out of the finish he deserved. So when you have speed in Vegas, it makes you really look forward to Texas, because you're like a lot of the same tendencies and characteristics to drive fast at this track that you have in Vegas.
And he's going to get some top 10 finishes, too. He does not have any yet in his career. 11th is his best finish.
See Zane losing his nose there a little bit as Eckes and Rhodes drive away.
I don't think Zane's truck is exactly where he wants it yet, but you give Chris Larson a couple more tries at it, and we'll see it make no difference.
Yeah, driving from 18th up inside the top 5 that quick with a lot more race to go. I feel good about the adjustments that that team will make together.
See, there are 36 laps to go in stage one. This is a longer truck race than we've had the last couple of years. We've added 18 laps. It's 27 miles longer, so we're going the full 250 miles here tonight.
Looks like a pretty good handling truck. You didn't see a whole lot of messing with the steering wheel, and last time by, he was just a couple of tenths off the fastest truck on the track.
Yeah, if you see his right hand go way over the top of the steering wheel, that would mean he was probably a little tight, or obviously if he had to turn back to the right, then he would be a little bit too loose, but it looked like he was pretty neutral there.
Matt Crafton leads this group of trucks. Kobe Heyer, you see there.
Brett Holmes in the 32, battle for 16th back there side by side. There's racing all over the place.
Matt Crafton, I said, leading this group, 14th, so he's made a little bit of progress after that adjustment. You expect the experienced veteran that Crafton is to be able to tell the team exactly what he needs to make the truck even better yet. Then down on the bottom, Jack Wood, we saw those big problems he had at the start of the race, but he seems to have stabilized inside the top 20.
Yeah, Jack Wood started on the front row, obviously a fast truck, but he slipped up, saved it early on. I believe it was the initial start of the race, and he was never able to recover. So running back there, trying to make his way forward.
There's Majeski getting around
Chase Ford Purdy, truck. Yeah.
Chase Purdy losing a little bit of ground. Here comes Grant Enfinger just behind him.
Good start to the year for Chase Purdy with a couple top 10 finishes at Vegas and Atlanta.
Talked to him in Atlanta down in the garage area, and he says, we're going to do some good stuff with this Bama buggy this year. That's his sponsor on the side. You see Ankrum again loose, and here comes Carson Hosevar. Will he take him on the bottom? Yes, he does.
Yeah, Jack Wood, the 51, got him on the outside. Mentioned Jack Wood a few moments ago. Jack's fighting his way back here.
Carson Hosevar and Ankrum nearly ended their race just a few laps ago. Now it looks like Carson's heading in the right direction, and Ankrum not so much.
Nick Sanchez, Ben Rhodes, Christian Eckes, Zane Smith, and Dean Thompson, your top five.
About a second and a half lead for this, nearly 2 seconds now for Nick Sanchez. He's driving away, Jamie.
44 laps left and counting. Plenty more action from Texas after this. Welcome back to Craftsman Truck Series Racing from Texas. Jamie Little, Phil Parsons, Michael Waltrip with you. Jamie Howe and Heather DeBow on pit road. Nothing has changed. Nick Sanchez and that two truck just continued to lead. Ben Rhodes, Christian Eckes, Zane Smith, and Dean Thompson, your top five.
Some great story up here in the top five. There's Jake Garcia at the 35. There's Rajat Caruth, the 24. They're battling for the 12th spot right now in front of Matt Crafton. Remember, Matt made an early pit stop on an early caution flag for some adjustments, as well as the competition caution. Ooh, a little bit loose for Jake Garcia for the 35 truck.
Phil, I remember one day I was racing at Darlington, and Brian Vickers and Kyle Busch were leading me, and I was third, and the laps were running down, and I got to doing the math, and I added their age together, and they were still younger than me. That'll get your attention on the racetrack, and I think that's what Matt Crafton is faced with right now. And so he's wanting to get rid of these guys, get ahead of them, and march on up toward the top 10. Making some good progress is the 99 or 88 of Crafton.
And remember, 11 drivers were not born when he ran his first race at this racetrack.
That's a heck of a stat right there.
There's Grant Enfinger making his way inside the top 10, racing with Taylor Gray. Rajah there. Rajah's had a good start to this race.
He has. What a great job by Dean Thompson. You guys talked about it a few moments ago. We saw some flashes. I know we talked about it last year, Michael, that he seemed to get more out of his equipment than we thought he could. And now this is obviously really good equipment with Tricon Garage, and man, is he doing an awesome job.
Man, if you're a young kid and you're keeping pace with Zane Smith, with what he's done and we've talked about in the truck series, that's a good feeling for somebody that's aspiring to win a championship and win NASCAR races. That gives you the confidence it takes to do the job.
It's always interesting for me to see at the beginning of the season season, all these changes, and you know, who will prevail? Who will find that chemistry with that crew chief and that new team? And I think Dean Thompson is one of them.
Driver changes, manufacturer changes. It's been quite the playbook to study when we get ready to cover one of these truck races.
Well, Chase Purdy went through all of it, right? He goes to KBM. KBM goes through manufacturer change and moves to Chevrolet. And you know, I talked to Chase last week, and he just feels like, now that I'm at this team at KBM, I really feel like I can show what I'm capable of. I really feel like I fit in here. And you talk to his crew chief, Jimmy Villeneuve, and he's like, we have a chip on our shoulder at KBM. We want to win, and we really feel like this kid can, but we've got to learn to walk before we run with him.
He's doing another nice job here today as well, right now running in the eighth spot. Riding along with Zane Smith in the fourth spot right here. There he is. There's Chase Purdy. You like Bama buggies. You like saying that, don't you?
That's fun, isn't it?
It is.
I like saying that Chase is holding a Purdy wheel.
Purdy wheel.
I see what you did there.
Heather, what are they saying in the 42 camp?
Well, we saw earlier him get really loose and almost take out the 16, so he's been battling a loose race truck. However, it seems to be coming to him at this point. They just came over the radio a few laps ago and said, by far, you're the fastest truck on the track right now. And this team, they've had, unfortunately, some tough luck the past couple of weeks with some mechanical issues, but they've had speed. As we take a look now at the crew chief, Phil Gold, who's pulling double duty here today, and he is going to be the jackman whenever they make adjustments during these breaks. And I told Phil, we might get a camera on you today to see you in action. So he's probably pretty happy that we're showing him right now instead of during the break coming up later to put the pressure on him. Jamie Howe.
We all know it comes down to teamwork, and for Christian Eckes, one of his team members, his engineer, Austin Greco, has been a big help in getting the setup on this truck closer to what he needs week in and week out. They do that using the simulator back at the shop and then translating that into what they actually bring to the racetrack. Well, today, as Austin sits up on the timing stand right now, listening for what those adjustments might be, he's also got a little bit of arm pump going on because during that first pit stop, he was the jackman. So we're going to see him go back out over the wall again. But everybody pulling double duty today. It's been exciting to watch. They've got two more chances to do it, too.
That's a lot of fun. Thank you, ladies. Something to watch, right? Phil Gould, who's normally, you know, you do the strategy, you sit on the pit box, but he gets to get off and actually jack the truck. So, yeah, we might have to show a little shot of that.
Yeah, they said, NASCAR said, everybody that's on the roster, they have to, their teams have to submit a roster to NASCAR telling what everyone's positioned. Everybody on the roster can go over the wall on these non-competitive pit stops.
And by the way, next week, Bristol Dirt, non-competitive stops
exactly.
For trucks and the Cup Series, which talk about strange seeing these drivers pull in, turn off their cars, and watch the mechanics go to work. Something very different.
Dean Thompson's getting heated up by Ty Majeski for that fifth position. And, you know, we talked about that 2.5 second lead that Nick Sanchez has. Ben Rhodes has cut that down to just 1.4 seconds. So things are tightening up at the front. A lot of action on the racetrack. It's funny. There you see Nick Sanchez. He's looking in the mirror, and that 99 of Ben Rhodes, the Kubota truck, is getting bigger.
Yep, it's all about Nick Sanchez. 15 laps to go until stage one is complete. We're going to step aside. You won't miss a thing.
Craftsman is back.
And to celebrate our return to the NASCAR Truck Series, we're offering racing fans different Craftsman deals throughout the season. Because teams can count on Craftsman tools to get the job done. And now you can too. When you take advantage of the Craftsman deal of the race, you'll save on the tools that'll help you power through your projects. And this deal? Well, it's going fast. So scan the QR code now to get the current deal of the race.
The deal of the race brought to you by Craftsman.
Day. Welcome to the team.
Who wants to race?
I like this team.
Be part of something greater. Toyota, let's go places.
Being a NASCAR fan just got even more rewarding with the free Fan Rewards loyalty program. Earn reward points and redeem them for merchandise, tickets, VIP experiences, and so much more. Earn points from the track or at home, check in on your phone, complete your profile, or play fantasy racing to score your first points. Join and start earning today. Visit NASCAR.com/rewards to learn more now.
The Bristol Dirt Race. Easter weekend on Fox.
It's NASCAR
on the dirt. Some of the steepest bank turns on the circuit. Covered in dirt on a half-mile track. Under the lights in prime time. Chaos will ensue.
Who's gonna save it?
Holy cow!
The NASCAR Cup Series, Bristol, Easter Sunday on Fox.
Chicago's never experienced anything quite like this. The Chicago Street Race Weekend. For tickets and experiences, visit NASCARChicago.com.
Welcome back to Texas Motor Speedway. Well, look who it is. The 88 is trying to join the top 10 right now, trying to get around the 23.
Grant Enfinger says, not so quickly. Battled a bit there with Chase Purdy, who's driven away a bit. Stuart Creason as well. These guys are trying to get those stage points, Phil. Never know when that 1 point might get you to the next round.
Grant Enfinger has that 1 point as they run right now. Matt Crafton wants it.
Battle for second here. Christian Eckes trying to get around Ben Rhodes in the 99.
You know, one thing I've noticed, and I was watching Stuart Friesen, that battle we were just looking at, looks like that second group really has some grip. Stuart Friesen was running the second group all the way around the racetrack and gained some ground, actually pulled away more from Enfinger and Crafton. You see Christian Eckes right now running that second group.
You know, that's what I love about dirt racers. They're going to look around. That's how you're successful on a dirt track. You go where the moisture is, you go where the grip is, and they're real quick to do that on an asphalt track as well, to see if they can find anything out there that'll make their truck handle better.
Much like a Kyle Larson does.
Much.
Got some lap traffic. They've got to work their way around. Slowing them up. Woo, that was close. They came up on the bumper of Daniel Dye's truck, able to duck to the bottom. Ben Rhodes continues to hang on to that second spot.
Christian Eckes was not able to clear Daniel Dye. You see the ground he's losing to Ben Rhodes.
They've got this lead down to just a second and a tenth. And they were battling side by side. So if they get it sorted out, they might run our leader down here. There you see the distance.
Could have an opportunity another six laps or so to make some more adjustments as well. There's that Speedy Cash truck.
SpeedyCash.com, sponsor of the race, and they have a victory lane here in the middle of Texas. It's green. It says SpeedyCash.com all over. No pressure, Zane Smith.
It kind of blends in with the green grass, doesn't it?
It does. It's beautiful. Glad to see the sun shining. Weather's been great. This race is actually about 7 weeks earlier this year, so not as hot as it was in 2022. Battle for 10th. Matt Crafton trying to work Grant Enfinger. Got that lap truck up ahead of him.
Matt Mills gets down out of the way, but it kept Crafton from making the move I think he wanted to make. And look, Tanner Gray just gets right back on the back of Crafton. It's a great battle for this last spot inside the top 10.
Yeah, Stuart Friesen right there. The red truck just went out of the screen, bottom of the screen. He's also in that battle. He's in the ninth spot. Chase Purdy, the four, right in front of him. Stuart trying to make the move on the inside. That might cost him. It's going to cost him some momentum.
Might cost him that spot. Did you see Enfinger, that yellow 23 truck moving in? I don't know if he got tight or loose, but definitely out of the gas off turn two was Friesen.
And that loss of momentum carried him all the way down the backstretch into turn number three.
Grant Enfinger, the 23, trying to capitalize on that move. And Matt Crafton in the 88, watching it all unfold, trying to make his mark, trying to get in the top 10 here with just three laps to go in stage one.
Ty Majeski likes that top you talked about, Phil. He's faster right now than Zane Smith. We saw him work his way around Dean Thompson, and now he's trying to get the fourth spot.
Yeah, Ty was up in the top five on that restart and then lost about five positions. Now he's battled his way back all the way to fifth, trying to grab that fourth spot from Zane. If Zane gives him the outside, Majeski's going to go by.
There it is. You called it, Phil. He almost did it in three and four, and he made it work in one and two. That opens all these drivers' eyes. When the groove starts moving up, they know there's options. And then the crew chiefs have to get their brains in gear to say, okay, what is it going to take to adjust our truck to run if we need to be up high? What adjustments do we make?
Yeah, what does your truck do on the bottom? What does it do when you move up? And how can we split the difference there maybe a little bit?
Gotta love stage racing. They race like it's the end of the race. The battle here. Matt Crafton still in that 11th spot. The two of Nick Sanchez. 75 laps left already. Green white checker is out and he gets the stage win. Ben Rhodes second. Christian Eckes, Ty Majeski, and Zane Smith the top five. Dean Thompson, Corey Heim, Chase Purdy, Stuart Friesen, Grant Enfinger round out the top 10. Matt Crafton, the 88, just missing out.
Man, what an impressive start. That's Nick's first stage win of his career, and he's been dominant during this race. Great performance.
And he had less than a 1 second lead when he ended that stage.
21-year-old from Miami, he's been the dominant truck. Can he hang on? Welcome back to the SpeedyCash.com 250. Stage one results on the right side of your screen. Nick Sanchez picks up 10 points all the way down to Grant Enfinger, who takes home 1 point. As you see, all trucks decided to pit. Non-competitive pit stops. They have 3 minutes to work on their trucks. Heather, what are you seeing and hearing there?
Well, Nick Sanchez's team really happy about gaining that stage win and those 10 points. He just told the team prior to that caution coming out, it's a little loose in the rear. Now, remember, they didn't make any adjustments on that first stop, so they're going to make some here. He also complained that the water temp was going up, but they did say there was trash on the grill, and that was the reason, so they're going to clean that off as well. And then next to him in the sixth position is Dean Thompson. This is the best run he's had so far this season. Again, he's looking for his first top 15 of the year. He finished 29th here last year. He was pretty quiet over the radio until the end there, saying that he needs some rear security in that racetrack. He's just been all over the racetrack, so they'll make some adjustments for him on that. Jamie Howe?
And for Ben Rhodes in that number 99 machine, he just needed tightened up everywhere. He said particularly from center to off the corner, he was just way too loose. He didn't feel like he had enough grip that he was able to actually fight and defend anybody. So they're going to tighten him up all around the racetrack. Otherwise, I'm going to stay pretty normal for him. I'm going to move up pit lane to Zane Smith. They're making pretty significant changes to that number 38 machine. He said it was numb on both sides. He was really struggling with finding some grip. His crew chief, Chris Lawson, said that's one of the strengths that they have as a team is Zane's communication to him and what he's able to do with it is what's really has made the difference and allowed them to win races and ultimately last year's championship. So it's just status quo for him, ticking it off to get back out under green. Jamie.
Thank you, ladies. Sounds like a lot of adjustments there. A lot of loose race trucks out there as that long stage one is in the books. There you go. Longest stage one in the series history, 77 laps.
It seemed like a long time.
Now we're going to shorten them up. Get with it.
Yeah, that's 45 right. Laps for these next two.
Coming up next, it's fun to watch these different mechanics. The crew chiefs off the box, Phil Gould, he didn't run the jack all that. He decided he didn't want to be put on national TV. That's all right. More from Texas after this. In just 2 weeks, Real Football for Real Fans is back. The 2023 USFL season opening kickoff weekend starts April 15th and 16th right here on FS1, Fox, and NBC. Hard to believe it's just a couple of weeks away.
From the USFL. I like what my friend Denny Hamlin said. He said it's like the NFL, but only there's less rules, so it's more fun. But I can't wait to watch these guys go after it.
I think that's why they say Real Football for Real Fans. So tune in. That'll be fun.
But did he like less rules in NASCAR, you think?
There's times that, you know, some of the rules that are in place have caused him actions detrimental.
Sure, and then he goes on actions detrimental and talks about those actions.
Big week this week for Denny and a bunch of the race car drivers up there in Richmond. That's his home track.
Mm-hmm. He's pretty good up there.
Yeah,
yeah, he is.
Got the win last year.
Can't wait to watch those Cup boys tomorrow on the short track in Virginia.
Looking forward to that. Time for the choose.
Let's choose it. Three of them to the outside.
That's switched around since the first time, huh?
Now they're going three to the bottom. Everybody's on a different agenda, and I think that's great. I think that just tells you that both lanes are pretty equal. I would kind of like to be on the outside because you get so loose down there on the bottom, so that's a little bit of a challenge. You get the right start, though. You definitely want to take the bottom if you're on the pole so you can get down there first to turn one.
Well, it's been a good day for Danny Stockman as the two team has dominated. You're standing by with the crew chief.
Yes, they have had a dominating day so far, and we've talked a lot about your driver and how much you like working with him. So can you expand on that and his impressive performance he's had so far today?
Yeah, he's just a special kid. He's always smiling and just brings a lot of fire to this team. And you can see by his performance today that he's the real deal. And we just got to keep tuning on it. That Firestone rubber got worn off there, and we started to build a little bit free. But the Gainbridge Chevrolet is really fast today. So hopefully we can get it done.
Thank you. Good luck with the rest of the race.
Thank you, Heather. It's always fun to hear from the crew chiefs. And he said something interesting there, talking about how that Firestone rubber from IndyCar is starting to wear out and the trucks are changing a little bit.
Yeah, it kind of confused me a little bit because I thought they probably would build towards tight. He said they're actually building towards loose.
You know, sometimes, Phil, with how precise the setups are on these trucks, when the truck starts to gain grip, the front ends are so sensitive. They start to stick better, and the back end starts to hang out. That's a real challenge. You know, you want those front tires to hang in there, and we'll see if that's what happens here on this restart.
Stage two begins. Nick Sanchez, Ben Rhodes with a big push on the outside by Christian Eckes.
Three trucks on the outside. We're pretty organized right there on that restart.
It's a real learning experience right here for Nick Sanchez. That truck out in front on its own drives much differently than it does with someone on that right rear fender.
As well as Zane Smith up there within a truck length of the back of that truck.
Ooh, look at that stretch out into the corner. We hear him letting off the gas. Nick just simply left his down further than anyone else and made it work. That was an impressive move.
They've all gotten adjustments, including our leader. Trouble in the back. The 45 goes around. That's Lawless Allen.
And he did not hit anything in those other trucks.
How
slid
did
by
he
him
do that?
Without hitting. How did that happen? That is crazy.
Was that a 360 or a 720 he did there?
He was 21st at the time.
I'm going to give him a 9.5 on my scorecard.
I need to look at that again. That was impressive.
That was a long slide.
He just got high. He was on the top of three wide. Just about saved it.
That's impressive.
Swap back the other way. And he grabbed it after a 360. Nice job. Nice awareness, too, to know when you're back straight. And you got to have your wheel straight as well.
I like how he didn't lock the brakes down forever. You know, he just drove the thing until the very end.
And look at all the trucks heads up around. About six of them had to avoid that truck. All right.
Is Daniel Dyer on?
He's getting overtime pay right now.
He's part of our broadcast team. For sure.
Look at this.
Wow.
What a great move.
Is that the 33?
Mason Massey? I think it might have been.
Yeah. Mason's on the lead lap. He got the free pass earlier.
So Lawless Allen with a heck of a save. Looks like he's going to stay out.
He'll have to come in, maybe get some tires with the flat spotting, yeah. But
caution is out for the fifth time here at Texas. Nick Sanchez, Ben Rhodes on the front row. In trouble for Ty Majeski about the same time that Lawless Allen had an issue. This happened.
Look at him just up ahead on the outside. He's going to get just a little bit wide. Ooh, he makes pretty significant contact with the outside safer barrier. He came down pit road. They changed the right front tire. It was flat. NASCAR allows you to change a flat tire. Visibly flat, they allow you to change it with no penalty.
Ty Majeski was fourth at the time of that incident. Green flag back in the air. Nick Sanchez, Ben Rhodes.
Good start by Sanchez. We've seen that all night. He's just been strong from the word go.
He just gets in turn one so well. Corey Heim sneaking to the inside of Zane Smith. Corey's in the 11 truck. Third in line on the inside. Then Stuart Freeze in the 52 right behind him. A I love the fact that we have two distinct grooves right now that you can make speed with.
And at the end of that first stage, it looked like maybe that outside groove was starting to have a bit of advantage up there. As the tires heat up, maybe it gets a little bit more grip up there. Dean Thompson again, just strong inside that top five in the five truck.
Ben Rhodes not as strong here on this restart. Sanchez getting away.
Oh, you hear Stewart just got a little tight there off turn four. That's probably exactly what happened to the 98 truck. Ty Majeski, when he hit that wall, just lost the front end.
Guys, Dean Thompson has moved back up in the top five. In his career, he had run in the top five for 13 laps prior to this race, and now it's like 32 laps in this race alone.
Let's get an update on the 99 of Ben Rhodes. Jamie.
During that caution that we just had, Ben had to literally catch his breath. He came over the radio and told his team that the changes that they made at that stage break, they're not really sticking the way that they thought. They're off at three and four, it's better, but when he gets up high, he said, I literally have to hold my breath. So he's not happy with what he has here for the second stage.
Ben Rhodes gave up a spot there. Christian Eckes to the second spot.
Greason's really struggling now. We caught another view of him having to back off there, and he allowed Taylor Gray to get by. That moved Taylor, who's having a great run at 18 years old, up in seventh.
Well, we've learned, Bill, doesn't matter how old you are, you got to show up ready to go racing as teenagers, and he's done a magnificent job in that 17 truck.
Remember, we saw him last year with very limited amount of starts because of his age, and looked like he was going to win the race at Indianapolis Raceway Park and got taken out.
Stewart's rebounding here. See if he can complete the pass. Not quite. Grant Enfinger in that yellow truck back there looking on.
Battle for seventh right there between Taylor Gray and Stewart Friesen. Taylor Gray, the 18-year-old out of Denver, North Carolina, the younger brother to Tanner Gray. Tanner Gray having another good run. Solid top 10 effort so far today.
Yeah, good start to the season for Tanner Gray. Had that best career finish, runner-up.
There's
at Daytona.
Brother.
There he is in the 15 truck ahead of Chase Purdy and Matt DiBenedetto. We haven't talked a lot about Matt DiBenedetto. It looked like the 61 of Anchorman went really high off of turn four.
Right behind them, Tyler was out of the groove, and yeah, I think he made contact. Rogers is slowing down as well in that 24 truck.
Yeah, Rogers being split on both sides. There's Anchorman fighting back now, that orange and black number 16 on the outside of Garcia.
Carson Hocevar on the bottom.
That's going to explain what happened to Raja. He got pushed into the outside wall by Carson Hocevar.
That's a tough break for Raja, having a good solid run and just got wrecked.
He's making his way down pit road now.
Pull out the fenders and hope for the best. Looks like maybe that right front is flat.
Raja Carruth was running 16th at the time of that contact. Get him fixed up. Jamie.
So he's just going to get back out there and keep going.
You see his crew member used an electric impact wrench. They gave you the option of using a pneumatic or electric impact. Look, electric is not going to be quite as fast as the impact, but obviously they feel like he's got some more damage there. He's putting the tire back on now. He probably will end up losing about three laps.
He's going to get back in the game, though, as he pulls out that left front tire.
Yeah, that's where he got contact from Hocevar. Tough break for Raja. Hasn't been the start of the season that anybody at GMS was hoping for.
Yeah, Raja Carruth coming off his season best finish of 13th at Circuit of the Americas. He's shown some really good speed, but it's been another tough one for him today as you see the leaders pass him there as he's on the apron trying to blend back in.
There you see Nick Sanchez pulling off the wall on the back straightaway, maybe trying to break that grab from Christian Eckes a bit. And there goes Dean Thompson. Is he going to use Raja as a pick? Yeah.
He's going to grab that fourth spot from Corey Heim. great job by Dean Thompson.
Career night for him,
without a doubt,
here in Texas. Talked about how well Nick Sanchez got down to the turn. You can see Dean really put some ground on Corey Hyatt with his entry into that corner. Talking about GMS, there's Grant Infinger down on the bottom, battling with Stuart Friesen.
Battling for the eighth spot right now.
Man, as the guy that won this race a year ago, Phil, this has got to be a little disappointing for Stuart Friesen in that beautiful Ferris Motors truck.
Yeah, we talked about Raja, not the start of the season that he was hoping for. Same thing with Stuart. He's had fast race trucks, just has had a lot of bad luck.
Yeah, and a couple of weeks ago, they decided to make a change with the crew chief. Blake Bainbridge is on top of that box now, so some adjustments coming with that. They know that they can build these fast trucks. They're doing things themselves with this team, and it's just taking a little bit of time. And Stuart Friesen, who won the race a year ago, he finds himself in eighth. Not terrible, but certainly not what we expect out of it.
Yeah, we talked about the fact that this race is, the weather's a lot different than this race. It's so many weeks earlier than it was last year, so sometimes that's just the difference in weather can be enough with your setup to change things.
Chase Purdy around Grant Infinger up inside the top 10. Matt DiBenedetto started all the way out back and now trying to battle his way inside the top 10.
Yeah, Matty D in the 12th spot started in the back. He had that suspension issue problem in their 10 minutes, 15 minutes of practice earlier today. They had to start in the back, and he's made his way up. So looking for maybe perhaps a top 10 for Matty D.
Well, Matt finished 10th in this race last year. He's got Matt Crafton now trying to get by him, trying to grab that 12th spot.
There's a power move by Crafton. He started off a little bit shaky, and he gets a little bit shaky there off turn four, but he's making some good progress.
Matt DiBenedetto there in the 25.
Just a little blip of the throttle there when he got a little bit loose was enough to allow Matt Crafton to pull around the outside of him.
Here comes Kobe Heyer, too, up into this battle. Kobe in that 9 truck.
There's our leader, Nick Sanchez. He has led all but 3 laps here at Dallas-Fort Worth. Plenty more racing action to come. You're watching the SpeedyCash.com 250. 19 laps to go here in stage number 2. Nick Sanchez leads him.
He's led an even 100 laps so far of this race, all but 3.
And it's been impressive. The restarts, he's been able to be very aggressive with that 2 truck. Ran a few laps side by side down on the bottom, but was able to drive away. But you know, it's so close, Phil. Last time by, Dean Thompson in the 4th position was the fastest truck on the track, and we've seen that a lot. Nick was only the 3rd fastest truck, so these guys catch traffic the wrong way, and with the draft, this thing blows up in a hurry.
It looks like Nick gets to about a second ahead, maybe a second and a half, and then it stays there. And I don't know if that's Danny Stockman telling him to save your stuff, don't overdo it, you've got a comfortable lead, or whether that's these trucks are that evenly matched after he gets that initial little second lead.
I'm surprised the 38 of Zane Smith hasn't been able to make any gains. He's kind of been stuck there in that top 5. He's had his hands full with Dean Thompson, who can't say enough good things about how this young man's running today.
Yeah, Zane was actually the 2nd fastest truck on the racetrack that lap to that number 5 truck right ahead of him, Dean Thompson. It's 2 laps in a row for Dean Thompson.
I like his line, too. He's not all the way to the bottom of the track, kind of in the middle, and he's making it work. Can see there, I talk about that draft. Zane really pulling up on Dean as they enter turn 1.
Really a coming out party for Dean Thompson.
Yeah, Tricon Garage. I mean, all 4 trucks on the track right now, top 10.
Yeah, that's quite amazing, really.
This lead's tightening up. Eckes is running down Nick Sanchez. As you see those Tricon Garage trucks you spoke of, Jamie.
What a great outing. So much work to swap those trucks over from Fords last year to Toyotas this year.
There's that lead.
And it was David Gilliland Racing, for those of you who are kind of new to this. This is a brand new team this year.
They swapped manufacturers, gained a couple of trucks.
And Johnny Gray is also a partner in that organization, and Johnny's two grandsons running right now, both of them in the top 10, Taylor and Tanner.
Off to a solid start for Tricon Garage this season.
14 laps to go in this stage, and you can see we're getting quite the battle shaping up for this stage win.
I'm impressed with what Rev Racing has been able to do so far today, that two truck. They won the championship together in the ARCA Menards Series last year, decided to move up to trucks, bring their driver Nick Sanchez along, formed an alliance with Kyle Busch Motorsports. And it's just working out. I mean, all those resources. And Nick is the kind of driver, he puts in that time. He's in the shop every day. He's working out. He invests time where he needs to. He talks to Kyle Busch, asks him the right questions. And then this is what you see.
And that guy on the right, Danny Stockman, knows what he's doing, too. Former championship winning crew chief in the Truck Series as well as the Xfinity Series.
Danny Stockman knows how to take some drivers to their first wins, huh, Jamie?
Yes, he does. Three drivers scored their first career win with Danny Stockman. Austin Dillon, Brandon Jones, Chandler Smith. Not too shabby. Those gentlemen have all gone on and won multiple races.
What about that Chandler Smith boy today? Did a nice job.
Congratulations. Chandler Smith got the win in the Xfinity Series up at Richmond.
Love it when our truckers go up the ladder and just keep on winning. And there's a lot of them that are in this race tonight that are going to do the same thing.
That's what this series is all about. Heather, let's get an update.
Well, prior to today's race, Corey Heim only had one start here in Texas, and he told me it really took him a while to adjust and get comfortable last year. So he said it's crucial that he has that experience this year to give feedback to the team on what adjustments he needs. Now, early on in the race, he was really tight, but he didn't want to loosen the truck up because he was afraid it was going to come to him later in the run. But that stage break, the truck was extremely tight, and now he's extremely loose. So they're still working on that communication to get that 11 exactly where it needs to be. The team did, however, tell him it looks better from our end, even though it might not feel that great for you right now.
That's when, as a driver, I would probably tell somebody, we ought to try to drive this thing then. You get really frustrated out there behind the wheel when you're trying to explain what your truck is doing, and they say, well, it looks all right to us.
Corey Himes had his hands full. He was on the tight side, then he's to the loose side. But they will have another shot at it. 9 laps to go in stage number 2. They'll be able to bring them in, work on them again, fill them up with fuel, put those tires on them.
Got a couple teammates right behind him, the Gray brothers, Taylor and Tanner.
There they are, Phil. You raced against your brother and I did mine. That's kind of an interesting dynamic, isn't it, when you're doing battle with your brother? We've seen them do this 2 weeks in a row. I think the younger brother always is sort of intimidated of the older brother, you know, give him a little bit of space, but you never know with teenagers these days.
I don't know.
Taylor might just say, heck with that, I'm going to go.
They had a little rubbing his racing incident, I think, at Circuit of the Americas, and it was the older brother who prevailed.
Taylor got just a little bit loose trying to go underneath Corey Heim.
There's the brothers right there, 15 and 17. They were close, just inches apart.
Did Tanner decide to jump behind Corey Heim to try to give him a little bit of help? Now Taylor's going to slide right up in front of his brother, Tanner. Instead of Greece, he's going to close in while they're doing that.
Wow.
He says, you guys just work this out amongst family. I'm just going to stay right here. When you guys make a mistake, I'll make my move.
Tanner around the outside of Taylor down the back straightaway as Chase Purdy closes in.
There's a lot of red trucks out here. That's what I'm thinking.
A lot of action, too. Stewart, that thing got away from him, lost the nose, and almost got into the outside wall.
Yeah, we've seen that happen a number of times off of turn number 4. He needs the stage break to make another adjustment. Blake Brainbridge and the guys work on that 52 truck a little bit.
Let's listen to Friesen radio.
That's just the throttle having to pedal that truck up off the corner. We've seen that view 3 or 4 times. He's had to back off off turn. And remember, that's the bank corner. That's 24 degrees as opposed to 20 degrees over the other end down in 1 and 2.
Wallace Allen, talking with that spin, he just pointed those lead lap trucks down to the bottom. Oh, and he's not able to stay down, was Gray. Slid up.
He's going to lose that spot. He's going to lose that spot to Chase Purdy.
You talked about these fast lap times that four truck is turning. Chase Purdy is on the move.
Taylor wants that spot back. That's a point here with just four to go.
Watch this. His truck just goes away with him as he's trying to squeeze around the bottom of the lap truck of Allen.
Yeah, Lawless got a little bit close to him, but he certainly gave him plenty enough room on the bottom. Just lost a little bit of downforce when Lawless pulled up beside him.
Now Stewart with a nice runoff turn two, but nowhere to go with it.
Stewart just cannot get off of turn four, it looks like.
How competitive is the truck series? That last time by Matt Crafton down in the 12th position was the fastest guy on the track. And look at Dean Thompson continue to march.
Battle for third, coming to two to go. You can feel the intensity creeping up. They want to get those stage points, but they've got to work around these lap trucks.
He had that spot, Jamie, but Spencer Boyd in the 12 truck kind of took his momentum away.
And was doing nothing wrong.
No, he just racing. That's part of it. Daniel Dye up high as Dean tries to get by him.
If anything happens on the racetrack, we know Daniel's going to have a bird's eye view of it.
Heck of a job, Daniel. He doesn't even know all these shots he's helped us with today.
He doesn't like it. Texted with his dad earlier. He said he got grass all on his radiator.
Overheated,
Front end and it overheated. And so that's led to the problem so far.
Yeah, he didn't make an unscheduled pit stop. This is a battle for 10th in the stage, the final point. We're on the last lap of this stage.
And Matt Crafton just missed that stage point in stage one. Now that the stage number two is about to come to an end, Nick Sanchez once again wins the second stage here of his career. Eckes, Rhodes, Thompson, Zane Smith, top five, Tanner Gray, Corey Heim, Chase Purdy, Taylor Gray, and Matt Crafton got that point.
Sanchez has pretty much won everything to win here so far today. Got the pole and won both stages.
Led a lot of laps, too.
A lot of laps.
Heck of a job for that young man. He's been perfect today, but it's not over yet. Can he hang on and stay flawless to the end? Stay with us. Welcome back. Well, it's been all Nick Sanchez stage points earned today. He's won 20 points. He earned those. Christian Eckes with 17. Ben Rhodes sees Stuart Friesen down there with 2 points earned in the first two stages today. Well, they're all on pit road, all going to work, getting those adjustments for a final time. Let's go down to Heather on the 52.
Well, for Stuart Friesen and team, they were hoping to get a few more stage points than that, but they're happy with getting some stage points because that was the goal coming into it today. He did say that the truck feels pretty good right now. He's been happy with the balance. He said he's tight early on in the run, and the truck gets better as it goes. So he really likes the way that 52 feels, and of course, he's got that new sponsor on there, and the sponsors are on the pit box watching tonight, hoping for their first win in their first start. Also, just a quick update here on our stage one and two winner, Nick Sanchez. He says he fires off really good, which allows him to manage and build a gap on the other drivers, but they're going to make a little bit of an adjustment here for him to make him better on the long run. And then also the five, he said, please go in the same direction here. I still need a little bit more rear security there for Dean Thompson. Jamie Howe?
Just a little further up pit lane in that number 19 machine, Christian Eckes. He told his crew chief, Charles DeNike, that he needed to adjust the air pressure so that he could get it to last a little bit longer to the end of the stage. He finished second here last year after leading for 40 laps. He said he has unfinished business. He got as many stage points as he think that they could, but in order to go for that checkered flag, he's going to need that a little adjustment for these last 45 laps. I'm going to move forward to Zane Smith, their points leader, who was frustrated after that 18th place qualifying, but he said the adjustments that we make, that's our advantage. I just talked to his crew chief Chris Lawson, and he said we're in a little bit of a pickle here. We're kind of married to what we have, and it's not working to advance any further for Zane. He said in dirty air it is the worst truck that he's ever had. All they can do is work on it to get to fire off a little better and give Zane the opportunity to be able to get into clean air, maybe get ahead, but once he gets caught up in the pack, he has nothing he can work with.
Thank you, ladies. Yeah, it looked like they thought about it a little bit on the 38 truck, and then you saw the wrench go in, like, okay, I guess we're going to make a change here. We want to be better, so let's not stay the same. We'll line it back up, get back to racing. Stay with us here.
It's time to take the stage, that sunshine on the speedway. Memories won't fade away of sunshine on the speedway.
It is a beautiful afternoon at Texas Motor Speedway. It's been a great day for racing. Our race summary so far, it's been all about Nick Sanchez.
Domination led all but three laps. As that guy was singing about sunshine on the speedway, it's shining on Nick Sanchez.
Yes, it is.
That was a catchy tune, wasn't it?
I like it. Showed last year's winner, Stuart Friesen. He's back in 11th, but it sounds like he's pretty happy with his truck. He just doesn't have that track position that he wants.
Well, he's been a little bit tight off the corners here and there, so I'm sure he'd like to make it better. I'm looking for this 19 truck to heat up Nick Sanchez in this final stage. I think Christian Eckes got the momentum. It's been a great start to the season for this young man. Maybe he can do something with Nick.
I want to see if anybody can get the advantage on that getting in turn one. After about a lap, he just drives it down to turn number one. They back off the throttle, and he doesn't. Just wonder if somebody could get in front of him, put him in some dirty air, what might happen. But so far, nobody's been able to.
Zane Smith in the 38th and 5th. He wanted to make some changes, so curious if that'll help him here. Let's get a quick update on Christian Eckes. Jamie?
I was watching to see which lane Christian ended up choosing. We talk about the spotters that aren't here, and his spotter for this weekend is Michael Self. And if you're familiar with the history of the Arca Menard series, it's that Michael Self that used to drive. They had a conversation about which one was going to be better. Ultimately, Christian opted to take the outside lane, and he was really looking to stay behind Nick Sanchez and maybe try to pull him back a little bit. Didn't pay off, but we'll see what he does at the restart.
I kind of like going up there, Phil.
I'm with you. I think so, too.
Yeah, but I like where Zane is also. He's going to give a big push to Nick. So I don't see there being a big advantage either way. But I want to be on that front row. If I get the perfect start, like you said, maybe hit turns one and two like you want to, you get ahead of Nick Sanchez, and maybe that's a game changer.
45 laps to go in the SpeedyCash.com 250. Nick Sanchez in the 2. Christian Eckes in the 19 on the outside. Let's see if he can keep him closer, keep him in sight on this restart.
This is when you really want the guy behind you to help. Ooh, I told you about that dirt.
That was Corey Heim.
See where you're going? So tough.
They don't handle this well down there in the dirt either.
You can't see a thing when you're all tucked in behind another truck on these restarts. And look at that mad pack of trucks.
How about Zane Smith now? Jumps out into the second spot, as high as he's been all day.
Carson Hocevar with a strong three-wide move up inside the top 10. And he's getting more.
Ooh.
Oh, that was one of the Grays.
I think that was Tanner Gray. Looked like he might have gotten the wall. He's losing spots. He got stuck in the middle for a minute. Now tucks in front of Matt Crafton.
A couple of big moments, but they've all kept it straight. Zane Smith picked up a spot on the Chews. Now he's picked up another spot since we got going.
Look how far back Dean Thompson is now. He's outside the top 10.
He hasn't spent much time outside the top 10 today. Carson Hocevar with a couple of issues during the race. This is what you need, Jamie, when you get a restart. You need help from behind. Give him a couple of bumps to get him going. And he clears Christian Eckes. Grabs a lead.
That was great timing, too, by Zane Smith to be right there on his tailgate.
Oh, no.
Something's wrong with Dean Thompson. We've talked so much about him. On that restart, something must have happened. He has gone backwards, and he is.
He's back up to speed now. Did he get to the outside wall? Let's take a look. Look right behind Matt Craft, right behind that yellow truck. Just gets a little bit wide.
It gets out of the gas wisely. Yeah. It didn't like what he felt. Didn't get into the wall. It was really loose off, though. You wonder if he's got another issue.
He's way back now, well outside the top 15.
That's Haley Deegan in the number 13 truck, just had him ahead of Brett Holmes.
Yeah, Dean Thompson shown in the 19th position. Like you said, it looks like he's back up to speed. We got a truck in the wall again.
Taylor Gray. Such a clean race so far, and now we're having a lot of issues.
Yeah, his brother hit the wall a couple of laps ago. As much damage as they do, I'm surprised they don't blow a right front tire after making that contact. You can see the replay here. Just gets wide, and there's no grip way out wide.
That's pretty hard contact right there, too. But you see him top left of her screen. He's back under speed.
Oh, how about this? Finally got somebody heating up Nick Sanchez for this lead.
Absolutely. We haven't seen another leader in quite some time. It's been all about Nick Sanchez, who's just been clean sailing out there. But they made some changes to the 38 truck of Zane Smith, and he is all over the bumper of Nick Sanchez.
This is as close as anybody has been to Nick Sanchez after one or two laps after a restart.
And you can see there's two of them that are there. Ben Rhodes is coming as well. You've got to like the experience, though, of Zane Smith and Chris Lawson. They can talk to each other. They've been there, they've done that. They can make those adjustments, and I think that's what you're seeing right now. But look at Nick, he just works that track, tries to get down low so his wake isn't something that Zane Smith can use, and it looks like it's being effective.
Look who's joined the top five. Carson Hocevar in the 42 back up there in the top five. And brothers continue to battle there. That's right outside the top 10.
And Tanner got really loose in the 15 truck. Taylor was able to get by in the orange 17.
Jake Garcia in the 35 is trying to grab that spot. Down on the bottom. There you see Garcia. Look at all these guys diving and switching lanes, getting all they can get here in the final stage in Texas.
Jake Garcia's had his hands full at times today. Shown in 12th now, finished top 10 in Las Vegas and really impressed us. Jumped in that truck there. He had just turned 18, so he was legal. He'll run full-time this season, so having another really nice run here at Texas.
And you look at the truck he's racing around, Tanner Gray, the 15. He's had a couple top 10s already this year. He's in front of Grant Enfinger, a multi-time winner here in the series.
Yeah, this is impressive. He does it every week, too. I like where he's at.
Let's get an update on Zane Smith. Jamie.
And for Zane Smith, his spotter this weekend is Matthew Long, who is the normal spotter for Romain Grosjean in the IndyCar Series. He just came over the radio, and he told Zane that the bottom lane and turns one and two is not working the same way that it was earlier in the race, and that he needs to adjust his line in order to get closer to Nick Sanchez.
That'd be pretty cool if you're a spotter and you win a race in NASCAR, and then the next day you can go to victory lane for IndyCar. He's got a shot at it, that's for sure.
This has to be getting Sanchez's attention, huh, Phil? You got the champ right there on your tailgate. And look, the champ, he just keeps it straight. He thinks that weaving around like that might heat up his tires, might just not be worth the effort. And you can see Ben Rhodes there as well. This is great racing.
It sure is. Nick Sanchez is the most vulnerable he's been this entire race. And you see what the draft will do as it pulls the 38 right up there to him.
There he is.
Battle for the lead right here. Nick Sanchez trying to hang on. Ben Rhodes side by side. Ben Rhodes through the pack. Zane Smith to the top.
Holy cow, what a move. I thought Sanchez lost the lead.
Oh, look at Ben Rhodes get loose.
Sideways for the 99. That was exciting. Zane Smith back to second.
We've got a race on our hands now.
Christian Eckes says, keep it up, boys. I'll be right there.
I'm coming.
It looks like a lot of fun.
Don't count the 19 out just yet. We've got a heck of a four-way battle up front. We still have 33 laps to go. These guys are racing like it's two laps to go.
Without a doubt. You can see Zane Smith moving around, trying to find some grip for his truck.
Zane Smith, defending series champion, a two-time winner already this season. He's stalking the young rookie, Nick Sanchez, looking for his first career victory.
Watch what happened when Zane Smith went to the bottom to make this pass. He slides up, Sanchez to the bottom to make this pass, and Ben Rhodes said, I'll be right there, and here I am. He tries to go between them both, didn't work out, but man, what great racing.
Yeah, Zane got a little bit loose as he got by Sanchez. Now he's right back on his tailgate again.
Phil, do you feel like that if Zane could get in front, he might be able to drive away from Nick?
I really do, but although I think the draft may keep Nick Sanchez in contact with him, but put Nick back in that dirty air for once.
And plus, the way that 38 is running right now, he's just able to gain that ground right back.
I like this line he's running here. Caution's on the racetrack, we're hearing.
Caution out now for the seventh time today.
Did Jack Wood have an issue with this 51 truck?
Jack Wood was back there in the 18th spot.
Is there some damage to the right rear corner of that truck?
What a start to the day it was for Wood.
I saw some grass in his grill, so he must have had an excursion through the grass, Michael.
Yeah, NASCAR needs to get that cleaned up.
A couple of them did on that restart, Michael. We saw grass and dirt everywhere.
Oh, wow.
He's really fortunate that splitter didn't dig in.
I'm and surprised.
Rip that off the truck.
Watch this. How does this go wrong?
He was way up against the outside wall. Don't know if he made contact or not, but when he tried to bring it off the wall, it just pointed him down at the infield. You really don't see any damage to the right side, but that quick, that truck is overheating. Running one lap with grass on the grill has that truck overheating.
Unfortunate turn of events for the 51 who started the day on the front row. Nick Sanchez, Zane Smith, stay with us. You don't want to miss it. Welcome back to the Craftsman Truck Series. We're happy you're joining us here this evening. This is the SpeedyCash.com 250, and things were getting exciting right before that caution came out. Seventh caution of the day, but Nick Sanchez, Zane Smith, Ben Rhodes were putting on a show. Let's hear from their crew chiefs. We'll kick it off with you, Jamie, with Zane Smith's crew chief.
And that crew chief is Chris Lawson. Made those adjustments there at that stage break. But I heard when this caution came out, you told him, don't use up all the stuff that we got. With 27 laps to go, Zane's still on the offense. What kind of equipment is he going to have left for the closing laps?
I don't know. We'll see. I don't know how hard he's been going or how much we got left. The fall off hasn't been very much. So more than anything, just not using up the fronts. We've been getting tight longer into the run, and I feel like that's probably going to be, if anything gets us, that's what's going to be. So he just needs to, he's doing all he can. We need to get by the two to really make sure we can win this thing. But if we stay behind him, it's going to stay tight and it's going to get rough.
All right, he's got that bullseye on the back of the two, Heather.
And Carson Hocevar's crew chief here now with us, Phil Gold. Phil, earlier today you had a little bit of an issue on a restart. So what are you telling Carson to do better here when we go green?
You know, it's really just luck of the draw. You know, we didn't get a good launch and got put middle of three wide and just went backwards, and it's just, passing is treacherous, and we've just been scratching and clawing all day to try. And actually, that last restart, we had some brakes go our way for a change, and these restarts are wild. That's where you do all your passing. So
now the fans want to know, why didn't you jack the truck?
I got overruled. We had some extra help, and they didn't want me out there. So
they got extra help. Wink, wink. Jamie.
Darn it, I wanted to see what Phil Gould could do as a jack man.
Well, he had 3 minutes. I think he's going to be okay.
There's his truck, Carson Hocevar. Rallied back from being down in 18th spot. Little contact a couple of times during the course of this event for Carson, but in the top five now.
That young man's day is coming, Michael. He hasn't won a race yet, but he has been oh so close.
Four times he's finished second.
And then he dominated Charlotte last year and just wrecked late, racing for the lead. Ryan Preece was the short end of that stick.
He wasn't happy about that.
Well, you know, racing's hard. And we're getting ready to see it get even harder right
now. That's right.
The laying on that right rear quarter panel is getting ready to ratchet up. You lay on that right rear quarter panel, the guy on the inside gets loose. It's harder to drive your truck that way. It's risky, but like Phil Gould said, when you get down to the end, you got to pull out all your stops in order to be able to win this race.
Guys, we've seen Nick Sanchez close the deal in the ARCA Menards series, haven't we, Jamie? He's been to victory lane four times in the ARCA Menards series, and they weren't all easy, so he knows how to close them out. If he can just keep Zane and Ben and those other guys behind him and get this lead,
I think it's going to be tough.
I think it is, too.
Nick Sanchez has grit, and he's in great shape, so he doesn't fall out of the seat. He stays up on the wheel. I don't feel like he gets really intimidated. I think he's taking this as a learning experience, but it's kind of hard to learn when you're the one leading all the veterans, right?
Exactly.
Well, we have a lot of racing coming your way next weekend. It's Bristol, baby, but it's dirt. Did you see all that red dust? This is a lot of fun. We hope you'll tune in and watch the truckers get it done first before the Cup Series on Sunday. And slideways, we're going to have William Byron. Willie B's going to be in the 51 truck for Kyle Busch Motorsports.
Joey Logano in the field.
Joey Logano. There it is, a lot of action on Friday, 5:30 Eastern, right here on FS1.
You really want to watch action from Bristol on the dirt sideways, but I'm thinking on this restart, we could have sideways action as well. Going down into turn one, it just really is tough to hang that bottom. Let's see if they can do it.
Zane Smith on the outside on the restart for the first time. Sanchez so good on the bottom through one and two.
Zane's going to stick with him, though.
Three wide behind them to Carson Hocevar up the middle.
Ben Rhodes fell off quite a bit. Carson Hocevar gets around him.
Christian Eckes in the 19 truck's able to get around Rhodes.
Nick Sanchez, Zane Smith, 1-2.
Oh, wow, what a great restart for Nick Sanchez.
Every one of them has been spot on.
Had the champion right there on his door. And here comes Eckes.
Look at the bright yellow Menards truck, the 88. Matt Crafton, the best he's been all evening.
Stuart Friesen up there racing in the top five.
A lot of comers and goers in this race.
Ben Rhodes wants to get back up there. He knows how fast he is. Had a bad restart. Able to clear Stuart Friesen in three and four, but he's loose.
Ooh,
up off.
Can allow Stuart to get a little bit momentum on him. Which one's Matt Crafton who cautioned on the racetrack?
Caution is out for the eighth time on the front stretch. Oh, deep. Oh, and a big hit after he had already come to a stop on the racetrack. Four different trucks collected there.
Is that
Trey Hutchins in the 14? Armani Williams right there in front of you in the 46. Oh, that was a big
Matt Mills
hit.
In the 20 as well.
What a mess.
Look at Dean. Great sight. Dean Thompson getting out of that truck. Look at all the damage on that truck.
There you see the 20 of Matt Mills, too.
Yeah, so glad to see Dean get out. Now we can get these other boys out.
Look at that mess on the front straightaway. The truck's torn all to pieces. Trey Hutchins.
They have to red flag this race,
yes.
I think. Give them time to clean this front stretch up.
The AMR safety team right there. Quickly to the drivers.
There's Matt getting out. Good to see.
Those are some of the scariest moments. He's shaking up. You see it.
Such hard hits. Gosh.
You know, we talked of speeds upwards of 190 miles an hour, and when something goes wrong, especially Dean had slid to a stop in that blue 5 truck, and the folks behind him didn't get slowed down. Smoke was everywhere, dirt in the air. You don't know what visibility was like as they came off turn four.
Jeremiah Williams rolling away. In the 46 truck.
NASCAR didn't elect to red flag the race. They've sent the trucks down pit road to avoid the front straightaway. There's Trey Hutchins.
Yeah.
Good to see that.
So everybody is out.
You can hear the crowd applauding, making sure all these drivers get out.
You just don't know in that situation, was it a lack of communication? Were you not being able to see? Like you said, so much smoke up in the air, you just don't know.
Well, it's good to see all these drivers walk away.
Well, we've seen all the drivers get out of the trucks.
Just always hold your breath when someone takes a hit like Dean Thompson did. Great to see the safety that NASCAR implements in the trucks, and the AMR safety team showing up on the scene immediately.
And the guys on the other end of that, the guys that unfortunately ran into Dean Thompson too, such hard hits.
Trucks always angle down as the red flag has come out. They always angle down the straightaway just in case it won't fire up. They can push the clutch in and roll down the hill and get the engine started. So that's why you see them lined up like that.
And NASCAR would, if they had a truck that didn't restart, they would push him and get him going and let them get back in their position. But you don't want to have to mess with that as a driver. You'd rather do it yourself.
I just hate it for Dean Thompson. We talked so much about him having just a career race.
Spent 70 laps in the top five in this race.
So we are red flagged here with 22 laps to go as cleanup continues. Some destroyed race trucks. Now let's look back at exactly what happened here, gentlemen.
Oh, Dean Thompson loose into the outside wall. You see there's 10 or 12 trucks heading that way. And the caution comes out immediately. But look at he's hidden behind a cloud of smoke. Yeah. You can't see where you're going on the racetrack.
And now there's a lot of smoke. Looks like Matt Mills is the first one that gets there. Mills. Looks like Trey Hutchins turned right to try to avoid the five. See if we can get another view of it. There he is in the outside wall. He bounced off the wall into Ankrum pretty hard as well.
You got to make a decision. Is he going to go low or is he going to go high? And everybody ahead of Mills went low, and he elected to do that as well, but the hole closed up.
Yeah, when Matt hit him, it pushed him to the outside. That's why Trey Hutchins, the 14, wasn't able to get by.
Look at this mess.
You see two trucks go right through the grass, kick up all the grass right there.
What a hit. Ankrum has a lot of damage, too. We saw him hit the outside wall coming off four. They also hit the wall just past the start-finish line. There's Ankrum hitting the wall again.
Wow, you can hear it.
And Matt had really slowed down a lot, too, before he made contact.
It's going to show you how violent this is. You can see the truck sneaking by on the bottom. I think Matt Mills probably changed his mind. He didn't think he could fit through the bottom and tried to go high. But with all the dirt on the track, Phil, his truck just simply wouldn't turn. And he made heavy contact, as did Trey Hutchins, Armani Williams as well.
At speed coming out of turn four, caution had just waved. But at that point, you can't see the caution. You can't see anything at that point.
Dean got out of the truck, but I'm sure
he's kind of sat down right away beside the truck.
I'm sure his adrenaline, you know, had him up and out of the truck, but then sat down. And, you know, we're going to always make sure to be cautious and to take into consideration how the driver is feeling in that moment. And they decided it was best to put him on the stretcher and put him in the ambulance.
Driver safety is paramount for this AMR safety team and all of NASCAR.
And Phil, I know you have a son out there racing in the Xfinity Series, and it just brings you some sort of comfort knowing that you're going to get that type of response that quickly from the safety team.
Yeah, without a doubt.
Just really quickly remind you how fast 190 miles an hour is when something goes wrong.
Absolutely. You see the ambulance there with Dean Thompson loaded up. They'll take him to a local hospital for further evaluation. As cleanup continues here, we're under red flag, 22 laps to go from Dallas.
Today in Pomona, California, 16-time Funny Car champion John Force walked away from this scary-looking crash in qualifying for the Winter Nationals. Get the full story plus Mission Too Fast, Too Tasty challenge coverage coming up next on FS1.
Yeah, welcome back to Texas Motor Speedway. As you see, we remain under red right now with 22 laps to go as cleanup continues. For the caution that came out for the eighth time, four drivers involved. All drivers have gone to the care center for further evaluation. And as soon as we get an update, we will bring it to you. But you see the aftermath, just a mess. Four destroyed race trucks, grass, oil, all over the track.
Yeah, massive cleanup going on right now, but they'll jump on that. It's amazing how quickly they can turn that racetrack back into raceable conditions.
Well, it's been a heck of a race so far. Let's look back at what got us to this point.
It happened early.
All Nick Sanchez, that two truck was strong from the get-go.
Very first lap, Chad Chastain gets into the outside wall.
You can see the team trying to repair that truck, but he would later have it happen again and went straight to the garage. Look at this action, though. Tyler Ankrum trying to cut off Kobe Howard. Contact there into turn three, and look at the smoke off the Ankrum truck.
He was able to make it to the end of the stage. That was won by Nick Sanchez for his first ever stage win here in the Craftsman Truck Series.
See a spin off turn two, a 360. What a great job hanging onto his truck, and drivers just driving through the smoke and barely avoiding Lawless Allen as he went for a ride off turn two.
Great battle here lately. The 38 of Zane Smith.
What about
jumping
Zane?
By the two, and it didn't last long. It lasted about 200 yards. And oh, by the way, here comes Ben Rhodes to grab the second spot for a moment.
First time Nick Sanchez has really been pushed for the lead. So we had a heck of a battle going until this moment.
Terrible crash off turn four when Dean Thompson gets loose and slipping and sliding through the dirt and grass. Kept some truckers that just couldn't get their vehicles into that infield grass below Dean Thompson.
You know, it's amazing when we saw Dean Thompson get loose, how little room you have when you lose that grip, Michael, how quickly that outside wall comes up like it did for Dean Thompson.
And just think about, Phil, how narrow that part of the racetrack is with dirt and grass on the track. I mean, it's a pretty sharp turn anyway, and you have all the debris and can't see where you're going. Almost unavoidable for some of those drivers.
Cleanup continues. We're going to step aside. You won't miss anything on side-by-side, but we will get them back going. 22 laps to go. From Texas.
Out here, you're more than just a landowner. You're a gardener, a landscaper, a hunter. Because you didn't settle for ordinary. Same goes for your equipment. Versatile, powerful, durable Kubota equipment. More goes into it, so you get more out of it.
Craftsman is back.
And to celebrate our return to the NASCAR Truck Series, we're offering racing fans different Craftsman deals throughout the season. Because teams can count on Craftsman tools to get the job done. And now you can too. When you take advantage of the Craftsman deal of the race, you'll save on the tools that'll help you power through your projects. And this deal, well, it's going fast. So scan the QR code now to get the current deal of the race.
The deal of the race brought to you by Craftsman.
Here and now is when it matters most.
Heavy damage. Hobby boy!
Not last month, or last week, or 48 laps ago when that bumper fell off.
He's done.
Here is where it must be left on the track. The anger, the hunger, the passion, and the drive to do whatever it takes to make it across that finish line first.
Blow those rear tires off us, bud.
Now is when the future is written. In the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series.
Real Pro Football is back.
Here we go.
With the USFL kickoff weekend. Wow. April 15th, the USFL returns to Memphis after 40 years. It's a special season opener the city will never forget. Then, it's a primetime spectacular as Birmingham welcomes back the 2022 champs in a Saturday night kickoff.
All the way to the house!
The USFL season kicks off Saturday, April 15th on Fox.
When we call something NASCAR Legends, you best know we mean it.
Welcome back to Texas Motor Speedway. We're still under red flag. You see Stuart Friesen there. Drivers getting a little toasty in there, taking off their gloves as we wait out this cleanup. Let's hear from a couple of our crew chiefs. Start first with Jamie.
We've seen Nick Sanchez run just a flawless race all day, which leaves everybody behind him scrapping for position. Charles and Ike, you're the crew chief for Christian Eckes. You've been back there the second, the third, top five all day long. Knowing what you know about the truck that he has to take to the end of this race, how much more fight's in it?
We have fight for a short run. We have a little bit more speed that we probably need to get with the two. He's been flawless all night long, but I think we can give him a good fight here for 15 laps. And the 38 and the 99 are really good as well. So all the gains are so marginal in these restarts, and every position counts.
It's been great racing so far. Sounds like it's going to continue, Heather.
And here now with Stuart Friesen's crew chief, Blake Bainbridge. He's just let him know that there's a lot of speedy dry there on the front stretch. So what do you guys have here coming to this restart, and what else did you let your driver know during these runs?
Well, we've been fighting a tight, loose end truck most of the day. We've been working really hard. He's really happy with it this last run. But now we're going to fight all the speedy dry and everything on the front straightaway. But if we can get a good restart and get a nice finish here, top five for Ferris, really appreciate them being on board for the first time. Really excited for the rest of the races, and we'll see what we do here. It's going to be exciting. Yeah.
All right, the 52 looking for yet another strong run here today.
Blake Bainbridge, new with the team. I like hearing from the crew chiefs, kind of things that they're thinking about. He said Stuart Friesen pretty happy with the truck there, but now the track conditions are going to be a little bit different. And hey, if you're just joining us now, you're looking for NHRA, stay tuned. Watch the end of this race. You won't want to miss it. NHRA will follow us coming up right here on FS1.
See if we can take an opportunity while we're in this cleanup mode, if we can check it with Nick Sanchez. Hey, Nick Sanchez, Phil Parsons, Jamie Little, Michael Waltrip in the Fox booth. You got a copy?
I gotcha.
Nick, you've been doing an awesome job, buddy. What a career-defining race for you. But you got a lot of really, really strong and hungry competitors behind you. Nick, how are you going to keep them behind you and go to victory lane with this thing?
Yeah, thank you for that. Just got to keep doing what I've been doing in all the restarts, you know, protecting where I need to protect and, you know, putting them in a position to where I'll benefit. So just got to keep on executing on that, you know. My whole team on the number two Gainbridge Chevy and Save Silverado is, you know, they put together an amazing truck and it's wicked fast.
How anxious was that move when Zane was able to get by you on the inside and they got loose and then you got by him and the 99 was right with you there as well?
Yeah, that was a wild moment. You know, I didn't put together the perfect set of corners on my end, so I got to protect myself from that. And I think cooling my stuff down on the first leg will help my case.
All right, buddy, you've done an awesome job. Finish it off.
Thank you, guys.
Sounded like a crusty old veteran, didn't
he? Yeah, he did.
Talking about what he needed to do to close the deal, and that was a dicey moment when Zane got to the inside of him. What a great race that young man has driven, and he sounded cool, calm, and collected.
Those are the words that I was thinking as he was speaking, but that's Nick Sanchez, and he'll talk the same if he gets wrecked out of a race, too. He's just cool and calm, and he watches. He knows what he needs to do, doesn't get flustered by anything, and obviously, I mean, you mentioned it, he's got the hounds ready to scrap
to
right
attack.
Now. They're
to
ready
attack.
To attack.
And then our interview with Blaine Bainbridge saying, it's going to be exciting. I think he nailed it. That's exactly what I was thinking about how this thing's going to come to the checker flag.
And the caution flag has been displayed. That means we fire him up, get him back in order here. Well done by the team, by the track team, getting it all cleaned up. There was a lot of cleanup. And I want to mention that Trey Hutchins and the 14, Matt Mills and the 20 have been checked and released from the infield care center. So
that's
great
news.
Yeah,
for sure. We have one truck on the inside not able to refire again. The track officials will get him pushed off and get him back in his proper spot.
And there is a wrecker right there.
Oh, got it going. Yeah. That's Josh Rayom in the 22 truck. Josh being shown a little bit off the pace, being shown four laps down.
27th position, but he's soldiering on.
Things have been shaken up just a little bit. Looking down just outside the top 10, Haley Deegan in 12th. Haven't talked much about her today, been outside the top 15, so nice run for her.
So why don't we see if we can talk to Zane. Michael, you do the honors.
Zane Smith, Michael Waltrip and the Fox team, do you copy?
Here. Have a good look at all the speedy dry.
Just having a little bit of conversation with the team there, see if we can get him. Zane Smith, Michael Waltrip and the Fox team, do you copy?
Yeah, I got you.
What a beautiful move you made to get the lead for about a half a corner. How do you think you're going to stack up against Sanchez as he races toward the checkered?
Yeah, he definitely has a really good truck and doing a pretty good job of blocking. We struggled with our truck and got it a lot better today, and I feel like we're okay in dirt.
or in clean air, but struggle some in dirty air, clearly. So we'll keep fighting, choose the front row here, and hopefully get a good push from the 19 or whoever else that is, and get out front and hopefully pull away.
Well, that sounds like a plan. It's been fun to watch. We look forward to seeing you race to the checker, bud.
Thanks.
Doing a good job of walking.
Isn't that what he's supposed to do?
That's right. Stay behind me. Winners this season, Zane Smith. He's won two of them already. Kyle Busch at Las Vegas and Christian Eckes with that big win for Bill McAnally at Atlanta.
Yeah, two of these guys certainly have a chance at this one. Kyle's not going to win this one, I don't think.
No, he's going to try to win tomorrow.
He's going to win tomorrow, maybe.
He's pretty good at Richmond.
Yeah, he's already won this year in the Cup Series as well.
So. Remember back in like 10 years ago, these weekends where Cup was one place, Xfinity was one, Trucks was another, Kyle Busch would literally fly to all of them and race. Unbelievable. We're excited to drop the green flag. Stay with us right here. 21 laps remaining. And we are back at Texas Motor Speedway. 19 laps to go. This is the SpeedyCash.com 250 long race, 250 miles this evening. We recapped it. A lot has happened, but the best part, we've had a great battle at the front of the field. And I think we're going to see some more great racing. I don't know who's going to prevail. What do you guys think?
Man, I got to lean on the experience of Zane Smith. Couple of really fast trucks behind the front row and Eckes and Carson Hocevar. Whoever picks behind Zane Smith, the key to him winning this race is them get as good a start as Zane does and shove him out past Nick Sanchez. I know Sanchez has dominated, but Zane passed him once, couldn't hang on to it. I think he does it again.
I know. I just love how cool Sanchez is. We talked to him just a few moments ago, and you know, he could have been at the beach. You know, he was just cool, calm, and collected. He doesn't rattle. We've seen it in the Arca Menards series. I think he's the one going to hold him off.
You think he could have been like at South Beach? He's from down that way.
Yeah, he's from Miami, sure.
Here we go. It looks like Zane and Eckes on the outside, Hocevar and Sanchez on the inside.
We've seen Hocevar get really aggressive on these restarts. We saw him lose a bunch of spots, as Phil Gould told us about, but then he gained a bunch of spots on the last restart.
Jamie House with the crew chief for Ben Rhodes.
And that's Jared Prince. They were having a discussion over which lane to choose here, the choose rule. He chose the outside. Why?
The last time we went to the bottom, and it didn't work out for us. We lost too much momentum. So we decided this time we're going to the top no matter what, no matter how many rows we lost.
Thank you.
Well, you got to have a plan.
Yeah.
You know, it looked like Carson Hocevar had a heck of a plan on that last restart. Watch some of the moves he makes. You're talking about getting it done in a hurry. There he goes up the middle. Hello. Three wide.
The seas parted for him.
What a great move to get into contention to win this race. We know how aggressive he is. And look, it just opened up enough for him to get in there. And he took advantage of it.
Just barely. Just barely.
So good. Threading the needle for the 42.
Here comes Stuart Friesen behind him, and we know how aggressive Carson Hocevar and Stuart Friesen are going to be. These truck drivers, they get with it every lap of the race. This is going to be crazy.
Here we go. Nick Sanchez, Zane Smith on the outside. Zane.
Good pushes. Good pushes for both of them.
Looks like Carson's able to hang with Nick a little longer. Now Eckes is hooked back up on the back of Zane, but he loses grip, slides up the racetrack.
Eckes is going to lose a bunch of spots here.
Christian Eckes goes backwards. Nick Sanchez to the point. Zane Smith and Carson Hocevar to the bottom, trying to take over that second spot. Can't do it.
Here comes Stuart Friesen around the outside. His crew chief said he's really happy with his truck right now, and it's showing.
A lot of that speedy dry they just cleaned up. Still a little bit left on the racetrack. But Nick Sanchez trying to hold off Zane Smith, first and second.
Yeah, Carson and Stewart need to figure it out. Running side by side is going to cost them some ground. Did Ben Rose just bounce off the wall a little bit?
Yeah,
that orange truck.
Here comes Matt Crafton to the inside. Oh, Bama Buggy's got into Napa. A little bit of trading paint back there.
Ben Rose is back up to speed now. In about the eighth spot.
We've reached our Craftsman 15 to go. Can Sanchez continue to hold off Zane Smith?
Ooh, oh. Reese is so close to the outside wall. Looked like he had to get out of the throttle there. That allowed Josevar to jump in front of him.
You could see when he got up high, see how shiny the track is up to the right? Watch down in one and two. Stuart Friesen got up just a little bit too high, and he lost all of his grip. You'll see the shininess of the racetrack, and as a driver, you don't want to get up there in that part. Just really slippery up track. Where Zane is, basically.
The front stretch, one and two, all shaded, and you've got the back stretch. Complete sunshine, so different ends of the spectrum here with the racetrack and the conditions you mentioned, Michael.
Stuart Friesen into the wall. He almost hit the wall again, but I don't think he ever lifted out of the gas.
And he passed Grant Enpinger while he was doing it.
He was wrecking and he never let off.
Boy, Zane is committed to the top side here, or this at least the second lane in one and two. It really gives him a good run off of two. That draft sucks him right up to Nick Sanchez.
I just really think right now, Phil, Zane is faster, and he's going to use all of his experience, the champion that he is, to try to figure out how to put it on the rookie.
It looked like Nick moved up the racetrack a little bit that time in three and four to try to take that line away from Zane.
Zane to the bottom. He's able to run in the turn very deep.
Nick Sanchez has just dominated this race, has led 152 laps. That 38 of Zane Smith has yet to lead a lap.
Nick Sanchez is going to have to be absolutely perfect to win this race.
Taylor Gray
in the wall. The 43 of Daniel Dye goes around. Caution out for the ninth time.
Well, Nick Sanchez, you did a great job on that restart. As you see, the 99 of Ben Rhodes had to come in and change a tire. He hit the wall. But you know what you get to do, Nick Sanchez? Do it all over again.
Yeah. Mm.
A couple of good trucks right there eliminated.
Taylor Gray, a lot of damage to the JBL Toyota. Daniel Dye.
Well, he's been our resident on board working for us today. He's brought us great pictures, and now he's showing us the view of the wrecker.
Oh, look, he got squeezed into the outside wall up off of turn number two.
And then Daniel got squeezed to the inside, his inside wall.
It's right along with him as well. There's Brett Holmes right in front of him.
That is a great job of driving. I don't care if he did go for a spin. He squeezed into a hole, and he did it very, very patiently in the middle of chaos. He was able to squeeze down low. I'm impressed by that move. It wound up being headed in the wrong direction, but it could have been a whole heck of a lot worse.
Let it roll.
You have to try it. Stay on. I don't think it. There he gets it fired. I think he was stuck into the inside wall, and maybe the truck wouldn't go into reverse or something, and they pushed him back and he fired it up and drove away, but he has some flat tires. Obviously you can see the truck vibrating.
Man, there was so much going on. You could see the 99 off turn two. We know we talked about the slick racetrack up high, and he got in that mess. Jamie Howe, what are they saying in the pit for the 99 of Ben Rhodes?
They're talking with a NASCAR official right now, trying to determine when they're going to be able to come back in. They did replace that tire on the pit stop. Then they left pit lane as soon as that caution came out, so they didn't lose any more time. But there is still some damage on the right rear of Ben Rhodes' truck that they're going to have to address.
Yeah, Ben's already being shown two laps down right now. And obviously by virtue of the fact that Taylor Gray, prior to that incident, was still on the lead lap, as NASCAR allowed him to change those two tires that he'd gotten to the outside wall with, even though they weren't flat on the rim.
Yeah, it's important to know that the rules are different this week because of being a standalone event down in Texas. All the pit crews are up in Richmond, Virginia, preparing for tomorrow's race. So you can change a tire if it's flat on the ground. And if you have a damaged wheel, it looked like they let them replace that as well, but that's it.
Tough break for Ben Rhodes. We talked about the season. He's had his worst finish, 11th. He's had three straight top 10 finishes in a row and looked like he was going to finish that way today. Well, coming up next, NHRA qualifying from Pomona. Now, earlier you saw John Force's big crash. We'll update that as well as Tony Stewart's progress as he's driving a top alcohol dragster this weekend. That's coming up next following the race here in Texas.
There's the damage to the 99 truck.
Yeah, once he recycled by the start-finish line, he's actually only one lap down.
Wouldn't be unlikely to get another caution either, would it?
Not at all. Not at all. And I could put him back on the lead lap and try to gain some spots back. But
said he wanted to run every lap. He's one shorted. Well, actually, he's nine short right now. But
one off the lead lap.
Needs to make up one.
See, the boys got the tires clearanced.
Yeah, I think he'll be fine to be competitive in that 99. There you see Nick Sanchez weaving, keeping the tires cleaned off. Then in the bottom right, there's the Cup guys getting ready for a big short track showdown in Richmond, Virginia.
And why they do that, why they weave it around is because when those tires are hot and you slow down, it picks up every piece of rubber that's on the racetrack. If you were out there running at speed, it wouldn't do that.
So Daniel Dye's had a bit of a rough go today. Watch this.
Oh no, that's all we need now.
His mirror falls off.
It's been the heck of the day. Here's the choose. We got
Stewart went to the inside behind Carson Hocevar.
And that'll allow.
It's going to bring Majeski maybe or Stewart freezing.
Majeski up.
A row or Majeski. Two. Majeski up to the second row. Granite yeah. Finger. Row three.
Ben Rhodes in the orange Kubota truck there.
1,400 guests of Kubota at the race today.
I was riding a Kubota the other day at Tyler Ankrum's joint.
Were you?
Yeah. That's how he feeds the cows. I don't know how that has anything to do with this race at this moment.
And now, next week, you're going to ride a Ferris motor.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
So you do it all.
It's just fun hanging around with these guys, getting to know the future stars of NASCAR.
Believe it or not, they do have lives outside of their race trucks.
That's exactly right. And this is going to be an amazing seven-lap sprint to the finish. There you see Majeski in the 98, putting himself in a position to give Zane Smith the push that he needs to grab the lead away from Nick Sanchez.
Manufacturer teammate, both in Fords.
Fords 1, 2, 3 in the points. Quite the start to the season.
First time since 2000.
How about that?
Ford drivers 1, 2, 3 in points.
Matt Crafton back there. He's not finished with this just yet.
Here we
go. Here we go. See if Nick Sanchez can hold him off for 8 more laps. Green flag. Really good restart for Zane Smith on the outside.
Great restart for Carson Hocevar on the back. Oh, and he's climbing up the hill.
Pushes Majeski up the hill. Loses that spot.
Stewart Friesen to third. Christian Eckes on the move.
Nick Sanchez trying.
Oh, trouble. Crafton's spinning. Is he going to save it?
Save it. He collects some trucks while he's at it. Caution is out again. Matt Crafton's just going to drive it down pit road and bring it in, but he collected a couple of other trucks as well.
43rd start here at Texas for Matt Crafton.
30 top 10s. It's more than a lot of the field have in there all together.
Yeah.
Tanner Gray had another good race going, had his issues here recently. He's got severe damage.
Nick Sanchez will hold on to the lead. He was ahead at the time of the caution flag.
I mean, just executing perfectly, Phil. Restart after restart is Nick Sanchez.
Grant Enfinger was up there in the top 5. Damage on his truck.
Yeah, a lot of damage. See what happened. Crafton is the first one I saw sideways. He's in the middle. Actually, Colby Howard got sideways. Maybe got into Matt Crafton. And then they all went into the outside wall.
See Matt Crafton with some contact there with the 0-2 of Chris Wright. That was the deal. It was a squeeze play.
Yeah, Colby didn't have a lot of room down there in the bottom, but Matt, neither did Matt in the middle.
You saw the yellow truck hit the white one. That's Chris Wright, and he's in the 12th position. He's been able to hang in there with these guys all day. See if that derails his hopes for a top 10.
But Jake Garcia, did he get out of that unscathed? That 35 truck.
I think he did. I think that was him flashing by the start-finish line just now.
Phil, it's hard for the viewers at home to tell. When you come off turn four with the double dogleg in the front, how narrow that racetrack gets if you got to make an evasive maneuver. It just seems like nearly impossible to miss someone unless you make your way into that infield grass. Man.
So a lot of damage there on the 23 for Grant Enfinger. Nick Sanchez, still your leader. Zane Smith, Stuart Friesen, Majeski, Ekis, top five. In ninth spot, the 13 of Haley Deegan.
How about that?
Yeah, she ran a lot inside the top 15.
She soldiered on. Obviously, right now, they want to know, they want NASCAR to tell them what the lineup is. If you want to dispute your position, then you pull up beside the truck and NASCAR will make that determination and they'll tell you it'll be the four in front of the 13 or vice versa. Obviously the 35 of Garcia is in the same boat there.
Yeah, there's electronic timing lines all around this racetrack, and when the caution flies, the last line you crossed will determine your position until the end of the race for the win. Then they use cameras and anything they can to tell, but just to keep order throughout the race, it drops back to the last timing line. And look at the orange truck on the top. Ben Rhodes said, I'm back on the lead lap.
Back on the lead lap, and he didn't have that much damage to his truck either, so I think Ben Rhodes, he's probably not going to get a whole lot of time, maybe just two or three laps, but he might be able to grab a handful of positions here at the end.
It's going to be NASCAR overtime.
It is going to be overtime.
Anytime I watch the race with my family, we always celebrate NASCAR overtime. Let's go.
How many? We don't want a lot of overtimes, though, do we?
What are we going to do about fuel if we have a lot of overtimes? Could be a factor. Heather, what's happening down there?
Well, we're going to catch up again with our leaders, crew chief Danny Stockman. Now, Danny, I just heard you saying some things to Nick over the radio. What are you telling him here as we go back green?
Well, he's got a really good race car driver following him right now, and Zane is no slouch, so he's one of the best in the truck series, and we're trying to teach this young rookie what to do and how to react to these situations. And he's done a phenomenal job all day. So we need to finish it out on top.
He sounds pretty calm and collected. How are your nerves doing?
Yeah, I'm pretty calm and collective. Their nerves are high, but I think he can get the job done. So it's been a fun day.
All right, keep an eye on that too to see if they can get it done here for their first career win.
Jamie, what do you think about that? That's an understatement, wasn't it? It's been a fun day. I mean, they've been so dominant.
He does seem very confident, though, doesn't he?
He sure does.
Danny Stockman is as calm as his driver.
Every lap that goes by, I get more confident about Nick Sanchez pulling this thing off. But this is going to be a crazy finish.
Zane has thrown everything at him that he has, and Nick's so far has been unflappable.
You know, and when laps wind down, Zane's going to get even closer to that right rear quarter panel of that two truck of Nick Sanchez, trying to get him loose under him. It's a risky game because if he gets too loose, he's going to take Zane out. They're both gone, but that's the game you got to play. Be interesting to see what Zane does on this last restart.
Patience wearing a little thin on the blocking.
I just think getting more and more aggressive.
I have not seen aggressive blocking by Nick Sanchez.
No, I think he's
just entire race.
He's driven a perfect race.
NASCAR overtime. Here's the rules for the overtime. It's a two-lap shootout. If the leader takes the white flag, the next flag ends the race, whether that's caution or the checkered flag. Caution prior to the white means we'll rack them up and we'll do another.
Yeah, just kind of last week there was multiple overtimes in the Cup Series, wasn't there?
Three overtime.
And then we go back to Atlanta in the trucks. We came to the checkered flag with the caution in the air. So had a big crash on the last lap. Been a lot of action in NASCAR in 2023.
Got to keep your head on a swivel.
That's right. Carson Hocevar was right up there in the front. Now he's back in the sixth position. Let's see how this choose shakes out. Been a lot of strategy around the choose today.
Yeah, Christian Ekis gave up a lot of spots on that last restart. See what he does here.
Tyler Ankrum with that damaged truck coming.
Just a little landscaping happened out there. Nothing to see here.
All right, Stewart's going to stay to the inside, it looks like.
So stays to the outside, Eckes
was going to go to the inside if Stewart went to the outside.
Well, we didn't never get to play that game. It looks like a lot of fun, doesn't it?
It does. It does.
Let's figure out what's best for me. Man.
Let's get a quick update on the two. Heather.
One final word here from Danny Stockman to his driver, Nick Sanchez. We are in Texas, so it's time to cowboy up. Jamie Howe.
And for Ty Majeski, it was a big decision there, which lane to choose. Ultimately, he was going to choose the shortest lane. They were both even, so he chose the bottom.
Cowboy
the top,
up.
Sorry.
I like it. I wonder what that means to Nick Sanchez.
He's from Miami. I don't know if he knows what cowboy up means.
Guess we're about to find out.
He's been pretty cowboyed up this entire race.
Oh. I like the feeling these overtime finishes gives me.
It's butterflies.
It is.
It doesn't get old, does it?
No, I love first-time winners. Love them getting in there and taking down the champ. If they can do that today, they're going to earn their keep.
Danny Stockman said we just need to finish this off and come out on top. Chris Lawson said we need another win.
Here we go. Can Sanchez have another perfect restart? He leaves good.
He's done it all day.
Zane's right there.
Here comes some pushes, Phil.
Nose to nose, into one. Out of turn two.
Oh, look at him squeezing down, does Zane.
As you said, he's going to get less room and less room. Got another wreck.
Wrecking behind him. Caution is out. Lawless Allen goes around.
He was running in the top 10. He really had a nice rebound from that 360 he did earlier.
This will be our second attempt at overtime.
Phil, how's your gas gauge looking?
I'm getting a little bit worried. I mean, obviously we pitted with 45 laps to go. These trucks should be able to run 50, 55 laps. But I think the number of caution laps we've had since we restarted at the end of the second stage or the beginning of the third stage might be okay.
Did you see Chris Lawson's hat? It's all jumbled up on top of his head. He looks a little stressed. Another caution.
I'm stressed. Let's see if we can see what happened to Lawless. Like you said, Phil, top 10. Racing inside of Haley Deegan just got loose on the bottom, like we've talked about all day.
But yeah, simply got loose. Yeah.
Not a lot of damage on the 45 truck.
Just touched the inside wall, it looked like.
Nice heads up by everybody around him. They're clean.
Look at all that smoke, and everybody missed him.
Got a couple of tires flat, looks like maybe.
Yeah, they will allow flat spots to be placed as well. They will examine the tires. If they're flat spotted, they'll let you go with that tire change. If they're not, then they'll make you come back in and put the original tires back on and have to start at the end of the longest line.
You can see not a lot of damage to the 45. He'll be able to.
That left rear tire is rubbing right now. See it? And that'll get worse in the corner.
Yeah.
They probably just needed to beat the pace car back out on the racetrack. They probably will come back in. They need to clearance that left rear tire.
Oh, yeah. And there you see the damage to the 88 truck of Matt Crafting. Lost his left front fender in the last crash.
Stayed on the lead lap, though, which is pretty amazing.
I don't know what all you can do there.
Ben Rhodes is up to the 14th spot after getting the free pass, the previous caution.
I think maybe a flat spotted tire for Matt Crafting. Looked like it had air in it.
Our official will take a look at that. Crafton, a two-time winner. He worked his way through the field nicely today. He's running up there in the top 10.
You know, they may have restarted that race, and he may have said, hey, I have a real bad vibration. I must have flat spots, because they didn't run that long, obviously.
They need to get that work tidied up, stay on the lead lap, because he doesn't have a truck that he can be competitive with. But this has been a really competitive truck today, Jamie.
Yes, and after she qualified 25th, Haley Deegan wasn't really that upset. The reason was they didn't have the truck trimmed out for qualifying. She knew coming in here that handling was going to be much more important, and there wasn't a whole lot of track time for practice. So they went that route instead, and it's really paid off for them. She has the truck that she's needed to be able to move up through the field. She's been looking to craft the top 10 all season long, and right now she's sitting ninth. So we'll see if she can hang on to it and finally stay there for the checkers.
Choosing.
Storm comes to the inside, Eckes to the outside, just like they did the last time.
Ben Rhodes, they see the orange truck. He takes the outside. Every position matters, racing for a championship.
Remember the previous restart, he had to start at the very tail because of the free pass. Now he can start line up where he chooses.
Look how treacherous it looks up high off turn two. That makes me nervous just looking at it.
Got an update on Dean Thompson in the five in that big hit a few cautions ago. He is still being evaluated in the infield care center, so we're certainly thinking about him because that was a big hit. So NASCAR telling us he is continuing to be evaluated in our infield care center in Texas. All right.
Let's do it again, Jamie.
One more time.
Well, at least one more time.
Double overtime. Yeah, doesn't mean it'll be the last time. Zane was able to stay right with Nick Sanchez.
He's done it all day, but Nick's prevailed every time. Can he do it one more time?
Approaching the restart zone.
Green flag is out.
Big
Sanchez.
Push. Big push on that outside line. Josevar's thinking three wide.
He got there. Josevar got there. Put Stuart Friesen in the middle.
Nick Sanchez stays the course on the bottom. He's led 167 laps today.
Oh.
Zane Smith hasn't led yet, and they're side by side into turn three. Neither one letting up. Did they touch? They touch. Nick Sanchez gets sideways. He wrecks. The 38 Zane Smith goes around.
Yeah, and Carson Josevar will be our winner.
Carson Josevar,
after all of that, they took the white flag. Caution comes out.
Wow. That move on the restart, jumping inside of Stuart Friesen.
It is unofficial. We're waiting from word from NASCAR.
Wow, what a race for Carson Josevar. We've seen him be in position to win. Today it looked like he was in position to run about third or fourth. And it looks like, as soon as we hear from NASCAR, that Carson Josevar will be celebrating his first win.
Chase Purdy drove across the start-finish line in second.
Nick Sanchez, I mean, a career day to lead 168 laps from the pole to wreck on the final lap there.
Tells him he's okay.
No matter what happens, it's just a shame for Nick Sanchez. We talked about it, Phil. They're going to just get aggressive. It's going to get crazy. And that's what happened. Such an impressive race for that young man.
Looked like Zane Smith was almost going to be clear of it, but he ended up getting collected. Christian Eck is collected. There's Zane Smith.
And as they cross the start-finish line, Haley Deegan is fifth in line so far when it's official. And what about Ben Rhodes? All the way up to seventh.
And completed every lap, which has been his goal.
Chase Purdy scored in second place right now. The other drivers are congratulating Carson Josevar like he's the winner, and I assume he will be.
What a moment for Carson Josevar, if it's official. Looking at the scoring pylon here, it shows Josevar one lap led.
Yeah. A big one, though.
Yeah, the right one.
Most important one, for sure.
And again, Phil Gould, Carson Josevar waiting patiently?
I don't.
Official word?
Pretty sure we're getting ready to. We will hear it shortly.
And you saw Phil. He said, "We're still waiting. Don't burn it down yet."
Yeah.
I'm not official, but I'm really sure.
Yeah.
That Carson Hocevar.
I am too.
To go back and see who was leading at the time of caution.
There was nobody left. Everybody else was crashing while Carson was driving away.
I feel really confident.
Yeah, I do too.
Wonder what his heart rate is right about now.
Wonder what Carson's thinking. Hey, I mean, I know. There was no one in front of me.
There was no one in front of me.
I'm sure of it.
There was hardly anybody in my mirror.
I was looking out the windshield, and there was no one.
We saw Nick get out of his truck. We saw Zane driving around.
It's official.
Yeah!
Carson Hocevar wins for the first time in his career.
What about Carson? He was just sitting there ready. It was like he's a drag racer for the NHRA. They said winner, and he took off, burning those tires off.
The 20-year-old from Portage, Michigan. We talked about four times he finished second. When is this young man going to win? When will it be his moment? Today at Texas Motor Speedway, it is his moment.
Home game for his owner, Al Neese, too.
Trying to get up on the truck.
They won't even let him. They won't even let him get up there.
What a moment. Your first career win. The emotion. He's an emotional guy. He's put it all out there. His mom.
Wow, I love that moment. I mean, as sad as I am for Nick Sanchez, I'm equally as happy for Carson Hocevar.
Carson Hocevar started this race fifth. He battled top 10 all day long, got himself in position for that final restart. Let's look back at how it happened.
Oh, just got loose inside of Zane. And we talk about the front double dog leg. You got to hang on your truck through there. And it looked like they made a little bit of contact, and it just got him loose. And look at the job Hocevar does, able to just squeeze through there.
All the carnage up into the wall.
I'm glad they slid up there and stayed up that way so they didn't slide down and have more contact. See what Zane feels and sees.
Looks like they touched him when he came off of Zane's truck. He looks like he got a little bit loose. I'm not even sure there was contact from Carson, was there?
No, I don't think Carson had anything to do with that.
Yeah.
There was contact after Nick was already crashing.
Right, he was going headed to the wall.
The reason why he got loose was the contact in the double dog leg and the air coming off of his truck when he pulled away from Zane Smith.
You're not going straight there. It looks like a straightaway, but you're not going straight there.
Check it out. You can see
that little contact
right there,
right there,
and that sends him that way. Yeah. And Carson, he leaves the gas down, but he wasn't the reason why that crash happened.
Such heads-up move right there by Carson Hocevar. Like you said, never lifted. Watched where he needed to go. What was going through his mind at that moment, he saw all three trucks to the outside wall and knew there was nobody ahead.
Yeah, Nick lost his momentum there, so that's why if there was any contact between him and Carson, that's why. And just like we saw here, as soon as they all wrecked, there was nothing in front of Carson Hocevar.
He will drive it to victory lane. We will talk to him when he gets there. But the man who finished second, his career best, Chase Purdy, he's with Heather DeBow.
Yes, and Chase restarted from the seventh position there. So restarts have been crazy all day, especially that one. Take us through what you saw.
Yeah, I'm not sure really how it all unfolded, but I know we restarted seventh and then waited up second at the line. Just being in the right place at the right time. You know, I think at one point with like two or three to go on a restart, we were 12th. So just nobody gave up on this four team. Really proud of everybody at Cowboys Motorsports. We had a really fast Bama Buggy Silverado. So Yeah, I still don't know how all that unfolded. I just kept my foot in it and held it wide open, and we got here. So overall, really good day.
Chase Purdy with a career best finish of second place. Jamie?
Well done for that young man.
I love that kid.
Talking about him.
See him down in the garage area. Always a big smile on his face. Very humble, very thankful for this opportunity, and drives that Ford truck to a second place finish.
Yeah, Jimmy Villeneuve with a great job as a crew chief.
How about another great finish? Haley Deegan in sixth. That ties her career best finish.
What about Jake Garcia? We saw him bouncing all over the place today, and he drives it up to the fifth position.
10th at Vegas, fifth here.
This is all unofficial, of course. We didn't know who won for a bit. We'll have to sort out all the rest of these positions, but they're going to have great finishes regardless.
Carson Hocevar, he's heading to the SpeedyCash.com victory lane.
Will they have his cash there for the win, Jamie?
I think so.
Yeah.
Big bags of cash.
They're speedy. It should be there. Yeah. Ready for them. The victory lane at Texas Motor Speedway is so fun. The flames and the smoke. And where's he going? He's never been to victory lane.
That's right.
He needs to be told. Spotter needs to tell him how to get to victory lane. They're going to open the gate up for him.
Getting another hug.
Those first-time winners, those are popular ones. There's the gate.
Worldwide Express on that truck for that team.
Bet Ross Chastain is smiling ear to ear in Richmond
right
now.
Got that right.
He's been a great mentor to this young man. Young man had to endure a lot today. 12 cautions for 32 laps. He was there when it counted.
He's had to endure a lot the last year.
Yes, he has.
Remember, broke his ankle.
Sonoma.
Well, Charlotte.
Charlotte went to Sonoma, put him on
the pole.
We have talked about him a lot, and for great reason. But a lot of people have asked, when is he going to get that first win? Well, the answer is today.
You think the maybe the key to this victory was that awesome restart we showed the replays of, blowing through the field, gaining all those positions, and getting in a position to be where he's sitting.
He's a man known for the hats that he wears, getting that hat just right, the flames, the heat in that victory lane right now. Carson Hocevar climbs from his truck. He is a winner in the Craftsman Truck Series, and Jamie Howe is there.
Carson Hocevar's 59th career start, and you burn these tires down all the way into the victory circle here. You've had moments to think about it. How does winning now compare to what you had imagined for all these years?
Yeah, I didn't think y'all were going to talk to me, to be honest. I figured I was going to talk to y'all there, but I'm just excited. I didn't mean to get into the four, obviously. I just went to give him a push, and they were sideways. The second I hit him, he was gone, so I apologize to them. I'll take the fault for it. I wrecked a Chevy, but hopefully Chevy is in victory lane, and I'll go talk to him. But he deserved to win for sure. But all the times that we're not the fastest car, and we don't like, or all the times we're the fastest car and I don't win, and this team don't win, and they deserve to win more than anything. And I finally can stop getting the same question asked so many times. So we didn't deserve to win today. We're just in the right spot at the right time.
With one to go, what did you see out the windshield?
I didn't see anything. All I saw was a big, like, I'll see right here, like, they hit pretty good. And I just tried to push, and he was sideways, so the second he crossed back up, I mean, I was coming so much faster than him just to help push. He crossed left, crossed right, and he's sideways, so the second I touched him, he went around. So I didn't mean to tear up any race cars, I'm sorry. But I wasn't expecting that to happen. So this guy right here next to me deserves all the credit. Out East, he believed in me when not a lot of people did. Wex, Chevy, Worldwide Express, Sparco, everybody. My family's here. My girlfriend's at home, Peyton. My dad's at home. My dogs, my dog Miley, Cal, Jet. So everybody's at home. But my Dave and my mom are here, and my whole crew deserves this win more than anything.
You are now a winner in the Craftsman Truck Series. Congratulations, Carson. Heather?
And Nick Sanchez has been checked and released here at the Medical Care Center. So, Nick, we just watched the replay there. What did you feel from the driver's seat?
Yeah, I mean, you know, it was obviously coming to the last lap. Me and the 38 were playing an aggressive side drafting game, and I feel like I went a little too aggressive on him. You know, got loose, went through the grass, saved it, and just got flipped by the 42. So I don't know what else to say on that. You know, after, I mean, all day just kind of in my own little race, and then for that to happen. But it is what it is. It's racing. Thanks to, you know, everyone on this number two Gainbridge and Save Chevy team. Truck's fast. I hate we tore a fast one up, but just got to build another one and come back strong.
It's hard to think about this right now, but you had a dominating performance, led 168 laps. This is only your fifth start, so how proud are you about your performance and the way that you work together with your team today?
Yeah, you know, this is what we've been working hard to do. You know, we don't want to win, we want to dominate. And today we dominated, but we didn't win. So just got to go back, you know, see what I could do better. I wasn't perfect throughout the race, so just try to go build on those strengths. And I guess positive is we got stage points, so it's something to fall back on, but I want to win, so that's my goal.
Thanks, Nick.
A couple of humble interviews there. You know, it wasn't a perfect night for either, but, you know, Carson Hocevar ends up in victory lane and a lot of people to thank.
Yeah, I tell you, Nick Sanchez, it might not have been perfect, but it was darn close to perfect for that young man.
Yeah, and he just got sideways, side drafting off the 34 truck, and I don't think anybody would fault Carson Hocevar for that accident.
And I mean, Carson certainly apologized, and he said the four truck, but he actually meant the two of Nick Sanchez.
Well, we are not finished here. We're going to step aside, but we'll come back and wrap things up. Stay tuned to NHRA qualifying from Pomona in its entirety. Will follow at the end of our show. And the celebration continues for Carson Hocevar, who wins for the first time in his career. And I want to update Dean Thompson in the 5. He was involved in that crash earlier in the race. Per NASCAR, he is awake and alert and still is under observation in the infield care center here at Texas Motor Speedway. So certainly keeping him in our thoughts. And, man, he had a great race going and had a bad hit. We do know this officially, that the winner is Carson Hocevar. The unofficial results right here in the top 10. Some career best finishes.
Yeah, Hocevar, Chase Purdy, a great run for Stuart Friesen, but Jake Garcia with a career best. I think Haley Deegan ties her career best with a 6th. Ryan Vargas, Jack Wood, both of their career best, and Ben Rhodes came back to finish with a top 10.
And the guy that came out on the short end of the stick was Zane Smith, just racing hard on that last lap. Young Sanchez got loose and took Zane Smith out. Sad for everybody involved.
Well, Christian Eckes was a driver we talked about a whole lot this race. He ended up in the infield care center. He's out now and with Heather.
Yes, Christian Eckes checked and released here from the infield care center. A wild ride there for you at the end, but take us through that final restart from your point of view.
Yeah, I don't really even know what happened, honestly. I haven't seen a replay, but obviously I ran into the 2. He was coming across the racetrack, so it's unfortunate. You know, I felt like we would have had a shot there with the amount of stuff that was going on, but just overall really proud of the number 19 team. We've been on it lately, and I guess there's a replay here. Yeah, I don't really know if I could have done much different there, so it is what it is, but overall, just super proud of everybody at McAnally-Hilgeman Racing. Obviously, I think Jake finished 5th, so that's super cool, and we'll move on to Bristol next week.
Thanks, Christian. Jamie Howe?
Well, Haley Deegan with that 6th-place finish tied her career best. You just watched the replays there. It was crazy right at the end of this race. Take us through what you saw from your seat.
Yeah, I was pretty pumped out because I thought we finished 5th, and then I just found out a second ago that we finished 6th. So not as excited, but definitely still was a great day, especially where we started the season. I feel like we're just getting the ball rolling, getting our confidence, and just building off of what we have every single race, not having to rebuild trucks, just making them better. So I think that's what we were really focusing on this race, getting through all the wrecks. There were so many big ones tonight and or today, and I'm just so glad we were able to make some smart decisions, avoid all of them, and come out with a good finish.
One of the things that you and I talked about earlier today was that you wanted to just be able to capitalize on what the strengths are of this team. You use that to your advantage. What was it that got you up front?
Yeah, I think honestly just staying in it all day. Like, I qualified not too great. I tried to get a little too much in 1-2 in qualifying and got a little free down there, so didn't have the best lap, but we were able to still, like, just stay in it all day, come back to the field and just chip away at it little by little, make the truck better as the race goes on and as the track's changing. So as you're moving around more, everything was changing so quick. So I think that we did a very great job of that, and my team did such a great job. I'm super thankful for everything that they've been able to give me for this race, for sure.
Taking a top 10 finish away with her, Jamie Little.
Great job. And Haley Deegan, new team with Thor Sport this year, and Rich Lucius, a championship-winning crew chief. They seem like they're really starting to hit their stride now. They've, the last 3 weeks, finished 12th, 16th, and now she ties her career best with 6th.
And she said it's early on in the race. She wasn't that fast, whatever, but they kept working on it. And that Rich knows what he's doing. He's a championship-winning crew chief with Ben Rhodes a couple years ago. They got better and better and better, and she kept staying in it. Like she said, she stayed in it. You know, avoided the trouble that we saw, and here she is with a great finish.
You know, we have a few go-to crew chiefs down in the garage. Phil, you get information from. Rich is my guy, and he just, anytime I need anything, there he is pushing the truck on the back right. Anytime you need anything, he's there to answer his phone. Gives us the insight of what's going to happen and the strategy around the races and what it's going to take to go set in victory lane. Now, this cat here is going to be busy for a long time.
Yeah.
He needs a bigger bucket, and he needs a bigger brush.
If he's going to go to blue, he's going to be in serious. I think he's going to be there all night. What do you think?
I think it's going to be a long night for him.
Now, he's got to paint those stars. Got to make them perfect.
Oh, at last, Carson's got on a cool hat.
A cowboy hat for Carson Hocevar. The celebration continues. We're not finished. Stay here. We've got more post-race response coming up. Celebration continues. Look at that, the Craftsman huge necklace. It's a chain, really.
I think it's sterling silver, isn't it?
I think it is. It looks heavy.
I bet it feels like gold.
I bet it does. Hey, if you're here, NHRA qualifying from Pomona is coming up in just a few moments. We're not ready to wrap things up just yet. Let's check in with Zane Smith. Here's Heather.
And catching up now with Zane Smith, one of the other drivers that was caught up there at the end as you battled for the lead. So you saw the replay, but kind of take us through that, because obviously restart's very crazy here at Texas.
Yeah, no doubt. First off, we got our speedy cash forward better all throughout the race, which was exciting. But at the end there, it was just overtime restarts. And then, here it is right here. I don't really know what's going on with the two, but he was just so sketchy, especially on the straightaways. And he doors me right there, gets off me, drives it through the grass, and then I just get hooked. We were in a great position to get our third win of the year there, and with the help of the 19 on that restart, and unfortunately missing the back end of my F-150. So we'll rebound and go to Bristol Dirt and hopefully have a good weekend there.
Now, we saw you going after Nick Sanchez there. You tried just about everything. If that wouldn't have happened, would you have been able to hang on to it to get the win, do you think?
Yeah, I mean, everyone, I was really surprised he wasn't taking the top there for one, but just once you catch the right rear of whoever you're battling, typically momentum funnels to the top there, and we were in just a great position to win. And, unfortunately, he was kind of a tart without feathers on the straightaway, so not much we could do.
Thanks, Zane. Jamie?
Thank you, Heather. What do you guys think of those comments?
Just like I said a bit ago, he didn't do anything wrong, he just got wiped out. So that's hard to take when you see victory out your windshield and wind up turned around. So Zane just, I think, was tough for him.
Yeah, and it wasn't a situation. Certainly Nick Sanchez wasn't intentionally going to take Zane out. He just got loose and then got... He lost his momentum, maybe got a little bit of a bump from Carson. Again, not Carson's fault either. It's just hard racing for two guys going for the win.
There's going to be a lot of hard racing next week coming up at Bristol. It's Bristol Dirt, baby. But first, tomorrow, remember the Cup Series live from Richmond. We hope you enjoyed what you watched tonight. We appreciate you watching. For Phil Parsons, Michael Waltrip, Jamie Howe, Heather DeBow, and our entire FS1 team, I'm Jamie Little. Congratulations. Carson Hocevar wins it for the first time. Coming up next, it's NHRA Winter Nationals from Pomona qualifying.